stations. Clear the air lanes. Clear all air lanes for the big broadcast.
So here we go, kids. Hello, everyone. I am Zazibar, and welcome back to the Sons of Sarazal podcast. It's been a little bit. We took a bit of a mini hiatus after the Shin Godzilla review that we did. Scheduling these podcasts has been a nightmare the past few weeks. Entirely on my end. I'll take all the credit for that. So we apologize.
He's too busy grooming. He's too busy grooming his mullets.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I've got a mullet now, kids. I'm about it. I like looking like 90s Superman. This has been my dream for many years.
You look at yourself in the mirror, you're Andres, like, yes, I need this. I deserve this.
Give him some credit, Andres. Obviously, he's been busy editing the entire time, haven't you, Bill?
Yeah, sure. Part of the time, a little bit. Past few days. So, we're back. As you can hear already, David is not here. But I do have Dylan McCandless, a.k.a. SuperDM64.
Howdy.
I have Andres Perez, a.k.a. Kaiju Noir.
Hello, people of the internet.
David might be along later, but it really matters. So, David might be along later, though. He when he gets out of work, he said he's going to text us, so Andres is just shaking his head like, no, like don't get their hopes up, don't get your hopes up, let's just move this along. So as we promised last time, since we had obviously a massive hiatus before the Shin Godzilla review, we're just going to do a news roundup this episode and cover all of the news stories that we didn't get to cover during the time that we were on hiatus. We're going to cover as many as possible. Obviously, not all of them. We'd be here for years. And, of course, we're going to keep it mostly with the big stuff that happened while we were away that we didn't get to cover. Because, you know, nothing really important happened in the past week or so. So we're going to mostly keep it with kind of older stories. So we apologize if you're looking for more kind of relevant new news items, but there's nothing really that we have to say about anything. Nothing really big happened. We've just got a lot to say about the Power Rangers trailer, so we'll mainly be focusing on that this evening. But Andres, this is your deal, so why don't you get us going with shit you may or may not care about with Andres Perez, retro style, past like 3 months. Andres, good luck, my friend.
Shit you may have cared about or may not have cared about.
Yeah, exactly. I feel like we could make a game out of this where it's like every single one, Dylan and I should be like, do we care about this or did we care about this? Like,
you should have like an entire audience. You should have an entire audience. Do you care?
Yeah, exactly.
The answer's always no.
See, I don't even think it's no. I don't really, like, it doesn't really matter if I care or not. Like, my level of caring doesn't impact this at all. Because I feel like that's kind of like the mindset with a lot of entertainment stuff, where it's like, it's going to happen anyway, so. People just throw up their hands like, whatever, I'll maybe see it. So, Andres, what shit may or may we not care about first?
Okay, so let's see. During our hiatus, it was announced that it was long rumored that the PS4 and the Xbox One were going to have sort of like a semi next gen upgrade, where instead of like kind of like a PC, how you kind of get a new upgraded PC every couple of years. And so Sony and Microsoft were trying to do the similar thing, and the PS4 came out with a slightly upgraded version called the PS4 Pro, which is essentially like a better version of the PS4 and allows you to do like 4K instead of HD quality pictures, it would allow you to have like 4K quality pictures if you have a 4K TV instead of an HD TV, because 4K is now, I guess, the new thing in terms of high definition, in terms of like quality, crystal clear definition nowadays.
4K, that's like... 4K is fucking beautiful. I've seen it in Walmart. It's fucking amazing. It's
That was so great. I saw it in Walmart, you guys. It was amazing. You sound like a housewife.
Did you buy it? Fuck no.
You sound like a 70s housewife. Just like, oh, did you guys see the new 4K TVs at Walmart? What an amazing thing. What an amazing time we live in, you guys.
I'm just saying, I could make out like ripples on the water and leaves in the trees and shit. It's fucking beautiful. I felt like Louis Armstrong.
You start sharing like inspirational Bible quotes on your Facebook feed. Like,
wait, did I say Louis Armstrong? I meant,
I can't wait to hear who you really meant, because I can't fucking fathom who you're talking about.
I thought, like, What a Wonderful World would have been a perfect song for this joke.
Wait, is that Louis Armstrong?
Yes!
Yeah, that is Armstrong.
I'm not even sure.
I see crystal clear.
Okay.
Definition.
Then I didn't mean Louis Armstrong, but after I said it, I started getting him mixed up in my head with Neil Armstrong, and I thought, wait, no. Although that could work, too. But no.
Oh boy, 4K definition footage of Neil Armstrong's trip to the moon. So
that would only make the conspiracy theories about the moon landing all the more like prevalent. I feel people would be like, "Oh, this 4K footage of the moon landing. How is
it's
there
too
4K
clear.
Footage? It's too clear. You can see the wires."
How did Stanley Kubrick get a 4K camera?
So anyways,
conspiracy.
A lot of people, the PS4 Pro has kind of gotten a bit of a black backlash because many people feel it's not significant enough of an upgrade for people to purchase it. And also the fact that PS4 doesn't use 4K Blu-ray discs, which have now been a thing for movies. Rather, it just takes regular HD Blu-rays and kind of semi-converts it to 4K. So it's not true full-on 4K quality. And plus, you need a 4K television, which not many people still have. You know, today, HD TVs are still, like, the thing that most people have nowadays in their household. So having a PS4 Pro would do jack shit if you still have a HD TV. And so
I'm just hoping that now 4K TVs are the going thing. Maybe the price on the 3D TVs will start to go down, and maybe I can get one and finally watch my fucking Creature from the Black Lagoon Blu-ray in 3D.
You gotta get those shitty 50s glasses, though.
No. They've done, like, a conversion on the Blu-ray where you can watch it through your 3D TV, and it's I wonder how good it looks. But anyway.
Do those TVs come with glasses? What is the deal? How do they work?
Yeah, they come with glasses.
The TVs come with glasses. Because if it was just a matter of having
it's
the little
so lame.
Shitty... If it was just a matter of having the little shitty red and blue glasses, then I could already do that, because I have a pair of those.
But they got those like green purple glasses, right? Or those like weird monochrome gray glasses.
They look just look like sunglasses now. There was a
The new 3D TVs. They just use what you see in the movie theater, just the fucking sunglasses that let you see shit like they live.
Yeah, it's a brand. There was a Predator comic that I read when I was a kid. I know this is gonna sound random, but it connects back. Don't worry. I forget what it was called, but basically it was about like a movie kind of producer, kind of like, not even movie producer, more just like film industry kind of huckster type of dude. Like, he was just kind of like, I'm looking for the next big thing to get people's money. So he came up with like the next step in 3D, like 4D kind of deal. Like, he's like, this is going to pick up rays that don't even really exist. Like, it's going to be crazy. Dimensions that aren't even real.
The space between spaces.
I'm sure you guys can see where this is going, but basically his kid steals the prototypes, right? There's like a film screening that's going on like near this guy's house, like that's promoting the new glasses, like the new technology. And the kid like goes outside, he's got the glasses on, he's like, everything looks the same until he sees the fucking Predator, because these glasses can see through the Predator's camouflage. That's the tact that they take. So this kid is the only one in the town that knows that the Predator is around, right? Now, at this point, I don't exactly know what happens, but I think the Predator figures it out, and he proceeds to try to kill everybody that has the glasses. And so I think the last part of the comic is just this kid, like, running around the town trying to get away from the Predator. and he goes to the movie screening by accident. Like, he just ends up there. It's a drive-in movie theater, so it's outside. And the people, they see the kid run across the screen, the predator chasing him, and they're like, that effect looks so cheesy. it's one of my favorite Predator comics. It's great. Anyway, sorry. I decided that was reminded that I never get to talk about Predator comics, so I wanted to talk about that.
And you never will for another 60 or whatever odd episodes.
No, never again.
So anyways, the PS4 Pro is out, and meanwhile, Microsoft is working on their Project Scorpio, which is going to be their version, their Xbox One equivalent of the PS4 Pro. Oh. So there you go. If you haven't bought a next-gen console already, you can take the chance and get these, like, 1.5 versions of the consoles.
I would just say buy that Predator comic I just talked about. It's pretty good. Just get Just get Dark Horse Predator.
And a lot cheaper.
Yeah! Just get that Dark Horse Predator Omnibus. You're fine.
I realized, I would love to see them bring back They Live in 3D, because then you put on your glasses as Nada puts on his glasses.
That would be really cool. Apparently the short...
Use that gimmick to its fullest effect.
Yeah, that would be great. Apparently the short story that They Live is based on... Excuse me. That They Live is based on is very different. And... Mm. Apparently better. So I kind of want to see a remake of that done with some modern trappings. There's so, especially with our current political climate, I think there's a lot to say with a They Live remake. But anyway, so let's get to the game then. Dylan, have you or do you care about this story?
No.
Okay, good.
I don't even care either, because I already have a PS4.
Yeah, that's the thing, too. I also have a PS4, so I definitely don't care. Would I have cared, though? I probably would have cared if this is before I got my PS4. I would have been like, oh, I'll probably just get that, but no, I don't care. Why don't we move on?
I have long since stopped caring or keeping up with, like, current video gaming. Like, I just play my old shit for the nostalgia.
You haven't played Battlefield 1, where you get to play as Lawrence of Arabia? You get to play as a woman who chilled with Lawrence of Arabia? That game is so fucking misleading. Like, there's this whole section of the map that's like, oh, Lawrence of Arabia in World War One. Doesn't that sound cool? Yeah, you don't get to play as Lawrence of Arabia. You play as some random chick. It's bullshit. Anyway. It's a good game.
So anyways, speaking of if you don't care about modern day consoles, then you're totally not going to care for the new Nintendo Switch, the new successor to the Wii U.
How does this thing even work again?
What this thing is, it's a home console, portable handheld hybrid, where you have a controller. And you have a screen, like a tablet screen, except it's not a touch screen as far as we know. And you have a tablet, you insert it into a docking system. And you insert the screen into the docking system that allows what's on the screen to show on the TV. And you have your controller. Then you can detach your controller, kind of split it in half, and put it on the sides of the portable screen. And then you can start playing your game on the go. It's kind of what they did in the... Did you guys see, either of you see the Nintendo Switch trailer? Because it kind of went through it all.
No.
Okay, yeah, essentially...
That's
you take the controller.
I saw pictures and I was like, how does that in any way function?
Yeah, basically you have the controller. Basically it's like you have your controller, then you take this piece off, you take this piece off, and you take these two halves and put it on to the portable screen, and then you can start taking your screen wherever you want.
I see, so you
or,
can build your own console. Okay.
Kind of, yeah, basically. And or you can just set the screen has a stand, so you can take the stand, the portable screen, and put it on the stand, take off those pieces of the controller, and start playing like a regular controller, but with the portable screen. So there's like a lot of different customized ways you can play with the Switch. Also, you can take these two controllers, you kind of flip them over, and so you got like a D-pad and a certain buttons, and then you can use it like instead of like two controller, like one controller, you can now have like two NES-style controllers for one screen. And then in the trailer, they also show multiple people with multiple screens all playing like multiplayer with one another. And so, yeah, there's like a various, you can, yeah, there are various different methods of playing with the Nintendo Switch. A lot of people were interested in the Switch because it's like a very interesting idea. It's kind of like what the Wii U tried to do, except they try to take with the Wii U, try to have like a tablet that you can supposedly play games on and not pay attention to the TV whatsoever. Unfortunately, you couldn't really take the Wii U's tablet like 10 feet away from the control from the TV screen, otherwise you'd lose a connection. Meanwhile, here it's like you can actually have the tablet and go wherever you want, out, you know, outside at the airport or with your friends at a party or whatever.
Andre's just chilling outside LaGuardia playing like Legend of Zelda or some shit.
Yeah, yeah, essentially. That's what they showed. That's what they showed in the trailer. A dude at the airport playing Legend of Zelda.
Wow, I'm like psychic. My God, my mullet gives me psychic powers. Jesus.
Are you even Superman, or are you that fucking Last Son of Krypton?
Well, he didn't have a mullet, though. If he had a mullet, I would be him.
All right.
The only Superman that Bill gets to be is black suit, no power Superman.
He had powers. He had some powers. He had a lot of guns.
He's basically the Punisher with a mullet.
He wasn't the Punisher. He was just like, well, listen, man, I don't have any power, so I need to use fucking guns.
So yeah, he's Rob Liefeld Superman.
Yeah, well, that was the idea. I like that Superman. He was a cool dude. Because he was still Superman. Like, he still acted like Superman. He was like, I'm not going to shoot anybody with these guns. I'm going to shoot in their vague direction.
See, this is why Superman is a pussy compared to Batman. Because Batman hasn't had powers his entire life. And that motherfucker, in most versions, fucking swears off guns, motherfucker. That motherfucker just goes out there and kicks some ass.
Yeah, maybe Batman isn't like, I'm going to literally fight an entire mechanical living city. So I don't need guns for that, though. Like, Superman was like, I'm fighting a lot of robots and aliens and weird clones of myself. I should probably take a gun. Like, that'll probably do me some good. Like, that's why I find Superman to be a little more practical than Batman. You know, he's out there with his ideology and shit. But you know what? Superman, when the job needs to get done, it looks like a job for Superman. So there you go. Dylan and I fucking
What? I'd like to see no powers, just guns. Superman beat Batman. He couldn't even do it when he had his powers.
It's true. Hey, that fight was never decided.
It was rigged.
Well, technically, actually, the mulleted Superman could fight when he didn't have powers. He trained after he came back from the dead. And there's a scene where like a bunch of thugs are like, "Ah, Superman, you're worthless. We got kryptonite. You're done." And he's like, no, I'm not. He literally just cleans them. Like, he just whips out his Kryptonian kung fu and he fucks them up. It's great.
I feel like I would like BVS like 10% more if they had the balls to just have Batman fucking stab him with that kryptonite spear.
that's such a sad ending, though. Oh my god.
he's fucking right there, and it's not even that sad because these movies have not made you like this version of Superman. I was really rooting for Batman to kill him at that point. I was like, yeah,
he still gets stabbed. He still gets stabbed, though. That is the thing. Like, they still had that moment. So,
well, he cut his face.
That's true. And then he gave him a little scar.
And he was all, yeah, Martha. And Batman was like, what? Nobody else can possibly have the same name as my mom.
Anyway, so Dylan, do you care about the Nintendo Switch?
I do not.
See, here's the thing.
Do you care about the Nintendo Switch?
Well, I like the idea. Like, it's a clever idea. I mean, it's the same thing with every game console, though.
I never even cared about the Nintendo Wii, so why would I give a fuck about the Switch?
Yeah.
But it's all about the games, though. It's all about the games. And if they announce a game that sounds cool, then I would care about their console. But these consoles focus so much on the gimmick of whatever bar they're trying to push in the industry that they don't go, well, listen, we've got some good games to play, so that's all you need, man.
That's essentially kind of why, like, the PlayStation Move failed and why the... Yeah. Xbox Kinect failed. That's why the Wii U failed.
Yeah, exactly. Because it's also like, this is why Nintendo has been floundering for years anyway. Because that's all they care about is the gimmicks. I mean, the Xbox and the PlayStation are the same fucking thing. Like, I don't care about all the fucking tech specs or whatever. They function identically to each other, pretty much. Same concept both ways. It's all about the games. It's all about whether or not you want to play Gears of War 4 or if you want to play Uncharted 4. Like, that's what you're fucking buying the system for. You know? Like, I'm going to have to eventually get an Xbox One because I want to play Gears 4. Like, that is how they get you. It's not about the gimmick. It's about the games. If they announce What is a Nintendo franchise that I actually care about?
That's right, because I've never really seen you as a Nintendo guy, ever.
There might be, hang on. If they announce
a fucking Super Smash Brothers game that crosses over with Dragon Ball Z,
okay, then
I'll give a fuck.
Okay, yeah, that works for me. Yeah, sure, definitely. Then I would buy the Nintendo Switch. But I want to see Link fight Beerus.
That sounds good.
In the meantime, you've got Xenoverse 2 to deal with.
Is the operative word.
I'm not excited about Xenoverse. Did you play Xenoverse 1? The controls are a mess.
No.
I played like 2 seconds of it and I was like, this is why I stopped playing Dragon Ball Z games.
I wish they had the exact same character building mechanic that they have in Xenoverse, because that's awesome, but just had Tenkaichi 3 fighting controls. Like, that would be the perfect game to me.
That's the problem with DBZ games. They perfected the formula like fucking 15 years ago and they've just been tossing shit at the wall ever since.
Yeah, they had Burst Limit, which was like old school Budokai, and then they had like Raging Blast, and then after Raging Blast they had Raging Blast 2, and then they had Ultimate Tenkaichi, and then they had Xenoverse.
When the first Tenkaichi game came out, I wasn't really digging it, but I'll tell you what, over the subsequent sequels, not only did they improve the control scheme and tweak it to by the point that it got to 3, it was actually really good, but it got to a point where I actually like prefer it over like the classic first 3 Budokai control scheme, because it gives you more freedom. Like, you can run around the environment and break stuff and shit. You're not locked in like the 2D classic fighting game system where you're on one side of the screen and they're on the other. And honestly, you play like Tenkaichi 2 or 3 for a few hours and then go back and try to play Budokai 3. You're going to get your ass kicked for like 10 fights in a row, just trying to remember how to do the old shit.
I feel like the older Budokai games are harder than Tenkaichi. Maybe that's just me, though. I've played those more than I've played Tenkaichi. I never owned one of the Tenkaichi games. I always just rented them. They're great.
It was really annoying in the first game because you couldn't transform in the middle of a fight. Like, you had to choose what form you were going to use before you started the fight, and then they fixed that in the second game.
That is dick. Because all the fun of those Budokai games was you wanted to play through the story so you could fucking turn Super Saiyan in a fight.
To me, the best thing about Budokai 3 is that it has everyone in it. At least everyone as far as 2007 was concerned. Like, any character that you would want to be in a Dragon Ball Z game was in the game. And now there's fucking mods all over the internet where people play in that game as fucking Beerus and shit. So it's like...
Launch is a prominent character. Experience her 2 different personalities and her 2 different hair colors.
Okay,
she's not the only one who can change her hair.
That actually would make the game better. I wish Launch was in the game.
Launch isn't in it? I'm kind of shocked at that. They probably miss a lot of Dragon Ball characters, though.
They are a little light on
the
Dragon
they've always
Ball
been.
Characters.
They've never really paid that much attention to Dragon Ball characters.
None of them are fucking fighters. Or if you put Launch up against Frieza, I'd pay to see that.
3 does have the most Dragon Ball characters in it, though, because it has Kid Goku, it's got Kid Chi-Chi.
Grandpa Gohan.
Pilaf and his little fighting machine thing, and then the transform form where Pilaf and his gang's fighting machines combine into the Megazord Pilaf, or whatever the fuck you want to call it.
Oh, yeah.
Tambourine and King Piccolo.
General Tao?
General Tao, and Cyborg General Tao. Nom, the guy with the Toybin that Kid Goku fought the one time.
Thank Christ. Wait, Popo? Is Popo in any of the Tenkaichi games?
Not as a playable character, no.
Why have you never Popo?
Because he's too overpowered.
That's true.
He's the Chuck Norris. Yeah. He's the Chuck Norris of the DBZ universe.
It was so rewarding in the last episode of Abridged to finally see Popo just chuck Vegeta off the fucking lookout. Like, that was so worth.
Also General Blue, who's one of the Red Ribbon Army guys. Android 8 and Arale.
Is he the Frankenstein looking guy?
Yeah, he's the Frankenstein looking guy. And then you can play as Arale in the game, which is neat.
What about Prime Minister Dog? When do we get to play as Prime Minister Dog?
Why would you want to play as Prime Minister Dog?
Because...
What are you gonna fetch your opponent's mail?
Like, yeah, well, sure. But I feel like if you enter a fight and you're like, I'm the Prime Minister and I'm also a dog, people would just fucking bow to you based on pure
respect. Also, he's not a prime minister.
He's gonna
Bill.
He was gonna make Waste City great again.
See, that's even more impressive. He's a fucking king. Like, you'd be like, that's so progressive for a dog to get to be our king. Like, that's great.
He's King Dog.
Yeah, exactly. All right,
anyways,
bust out something that we may or may not care about. Hopefully, this is something we may care about.
This was something that was related to the Switch, where they showed off like third party support by showing off like the latest NBA 2K17 or the latest NBA game, along with like Skyrim remastered. And a lot of people were really, really impressed because Skyrim was going to get remastered for the PS4 and Xbox One. And everyone's like, whoa, we're actually going to get Skyrim on Nintendo. Portable Skyrim. Holy fuck. And then that's when it was announced that like the people behind those two games, NBA and Skyrim, they said, yeah, we featured those games in the trailer, but we're not confirming that they're actually going to be on the Wii. We're not actually confirming that they're going to be a thing. So people were kind of pissed off saying, you were advertising games that are not actually, that are not even confirmed? What the fuck?
That's misleading as shit.
Yeah. So
by
who knows
way,
if those games
the yeah. NBA 2Ks and whatever. What are they doing? Like, every year with that shit, they're like, basketball is my favorite sport. I dribble it up and down the court, you know, all that shit. Like, it's the same shit every year. It's got to be a nightmare to be the designers of those games, right? Like, you got to be like, you get the assignment. It's like NBA 2K17. It's like, fuck. All right.
Who wants to make the last one?
And what can we minorly tweak to get people to spend $70 on the next one?
Oh, didn't they feature like Michael Jordan?
We'll make LeBron James's shorts a little shinier. That'll get them.
Didn't they have like a story mode with Michael Jordan in one game, like
How
two or three years ago?
How is there a story mode? What's the story?
A Michael Jordan career mode, story mode bullshit.
Yeah, you play through his career. Yeah, they used to do they do that on wrestling games sometimes. Or like, pick a wrestler and fight through his career. That makes more sense,
now.
I think.
I used to play MLB The Show when I was young. That was my sports game. And I liked that game because the whole point of it was you had to create a player and take them from the minor leagues to the majors. And that was the fun of it, was it's all about the story mode. It's all about the show of being in the MLB. So if it was kind of about that and like that was the tact that the whole game is about, I feel like that would be a little more fun. But they're always just like, it's all about like the functionality of playing basketball. And it's like, dude, I'll just go fucking play basketball. Like, what?
Like, also, speaking of basketball, that reminds me, there was a really weird part in the Nintendo Switch trailer where you had people playing basketball in the middle of the night, and then they busted out their Nintendo Switches and started playing NBA 2K whatever in the middle of the basketball court.
See, but it's
so it's like we're playing real basketball, and now we're going to play virtual basketball. After we just played real basketball.
I remember when my cousins, this is years ago. This is when the Wii was new. They got the Wii, and my uncle, who was a golfer like many of the men in my family, were like he was like, "You know, the great thing about the Wii is you can, you know, practice your swing when it's winter." And I was like, "Oh, that's great. That's awesome. I play golf too." So I was like, "I'm going to give this a shot." That is the biggest load of bullshit I've ever heard in my life, because playing the game and taking the swing, that would be like, and taking a real-life golf swing, it would be like if I was like, Andres, you've played Call of Duty before, right?
Yeah.
Well, now you're in active combat. Go. Here's your gun. Just go. Like, that's what that's like, you know? Because it's all about...
Where's the R2 button?
Yeah, it's like, when do I respawn? It's like, you know, it's like you're sitting there watching the kill cam. You're like, I'm waiting until I can come back.
Who's keeping track of my points?
How do I change my loadout? Like, you know, like, it's, who's keeping track of my points? What's my KD ratio?
I'm so glad we're not playing zombie mode right now.
Yeah, thank God.
Who's going to order the tactical strike?
You guys know what I mean, though, where it's just like,
yeah,
like playing golf on the Wii is nothing like playing actual golf. You know, none of which being, you don't really put any power into your swing, because otherwise you're going to break your fucking TV. So, and there was all kinds of like parody commercials about that when the Wii came out. Like, you got, there was one, it wasn't about the Wii. It was about like a knockoff version of the Wii, where it was like just some motion control baseball game.
Yeah.
And the guy's telling his friend how it works, and he's just like, oh, you know, you just play it just like we're outside, just like normal, like real life. And he's like, oh, okay. And he just chucks his controller at the screen when he's pitching. And it's like, yeah, that joke's funny for now. And in 10 years, nobody's going to laugh about that except for some guy in a podcast. All right, Andres, let's move on. Are we out of the
video games? You guys know what my favorite...
No, we got one more.
You guys know what my favorite video game... You know what my favorite video game commercial was of all time? This is some old school This is some old school shit. This is from back when I actually gave a fuck. It was one of the Call of Duty games was coming out. I don't remember which fucking one. There was just this commercial of this old guy. There's just this fucking old guy sitting in like a room like, everybody's doing it. Girls are doing it with girls. Boys are doing it with boys. And at the end you find out he's talking about fucking Call of Duty.
I remember that.
There were internet parodies of it all the place. Like, I don't even think memes were a thing yet, but it sort of became a meme in a way, like a proto-meme. Like, it was fun.
Yeah, back in the day, memes just used to be, hey, remember that commercial? Like, that was memes back in the day, you know?
Or that dancing baby with I Got a Feeling.
It was Spider-Man dancing on your phone. Like, you go Spider-Man to your friends dancing. On the playground, just like, look, I got Spider-Man dancing on my phone, and they're just like, you're a fucking nerd, and I hate you, and you'll never have sex with a woman. I know, but isn't that funny? Spider-Man's dancing. Like, that's really funny to me.
I guess the Rickrolling could be considered a meme in an extremely loose definition.
Yeah, that used to be called something else, though. It's not a...
Rickrolling.
I know, but, like, video... Like internet... Like YouTube, like, Or just viral videos. Like, it's just a viral trend. Like, it's not even, like, internet trends. Like, it didn't get the term meme until... the dawn of Facebook and Twitter and all that, and like just sharing pictures of Wilford Brimley breathing heavily, you know.
And who the fuck came up with the word meh? Like who did that shit?
I don't know, but I'm gonna look it up while Andres is talking about the next story.
Okay, so how many of you? How many of you
go to know your meme?
The two of you. How many of you among the two of you are aware of a game called No Man's Sky?
Oh, I'm aware of it.
I'm aware of it.
I've had my friends bitch at me about it.
Are either of you aware of the entire shit show, the entire controversy that erupted after No Man's Sky's release during our hiatus?
My friends bitched about it at me at dinner for like a half hour at one point. So I vaguely remember.
Right. So like about like 2 years ago, I want to say, at a video game show, and then later at E3, they announced this game, this very small, super independent game development team called Hello Games. They was only a small 12-person team that was creating this big, larger-than-life game called No Man's Sky. It was a game that was about everything and anything. It was about exploring the galaxy, exploring many galaxies. It was exploring all these different procedurally generated planets, where every planet was unique and had its own unique procedurally generated animal life and plant life, and all you can do whatever you want in the game. They were being super vague about what exactly you can do. It's just you can do anything in the game, and they made all these big grand promises about you can do this, you can do that, you can land on asteroids, you can go on space battles, you can make you can do like aerial dogfights and like Star Wars style, you can explore all these planets, you can all these animals, they interact with each other, they can eat each other, there's a whole ecosystem, there's like you have to go to this. You can eat each other. There's multiplayer. You can play with your friends as you're traveling the galaxy. It's promising all this shit, and they keep like hammering the fact that it's all procedurally generated, so that it's like every single planet, it's all unique, and every person has a unique experience. Well, the game came out, and it turned out to be like a lot of what Sean Murray, the man behind Hello Games, and the man who was kind of like the mouthpiece for this game. A lot of what he promised, a lot of what he said was complete bullshit. A lot of the features that were promised in the game was nowhere to be seen, especially multiplayer. He said time and time again that there is multiplayer, to the point where the collector's edition of No Man's Sky actually had a sticker placed over a sign that said multiplayer on it. But there's no multiplayer to be like the collector's box said. It actually had like multiplayer, but they put a sticker over it to
they
block
just,
the fact
they just,
that
they just scribbled it out with a Sharpie, and they just wrote, "This game was never meant to have multiplayer." And anybody who said that is wrong, including anybody who worked on the game. This is all on the back of every single copy of No Man's Sky you can check, and it's all in Sharpie, like it's all handwritten.
And
well, this is all I care about, though. Can you sleep with green women?
No, you can't.
No, there are no green women. It's all like weird-looking deer and shit, like on these other planets. Like, is there sentient alien life in the game?
Yeah, there is, but they're essentially
not my kind of sci-fi.
They're essentially just vending machines to go spend money and get a new gear for.
See, that's interesting to be sentient vending machines. My God, planet of the vending machines. There's like different. Are they all different kinds of vending machines, or are they the same vending machines?
They're the same vending machines. You get the same shit at different prices.
Now that's a game I'd buy.
If you're gonna go to a planet of the vending machines, you hope they're all different kinds of vending machines. Like you get those vending machines from Japan that are like they have panties coming out of them and shit, and like, you know, don't they give like Andres? There's some weird shit in fucking Japanese vending machines, really. Don't they sell like
Not really.
Really?
No. You have to go to like the most obscure parts of Tokyo for that.
Oh, I thought
everything
there was, like,
else.
Tampons and shit and like fucking toilet paper.
Andres knows all. Andres knows all about them sexy Japanese pictures.
It's all drinks. It's all drinks, man. It's all drinks.
You forget, Bill, that Andres lives in, like, the boring part of Japan.
I forgot.
I live in the Japan part of Japan.
Right.
Not every part of Japan is super wacky, awesome, spectacular, like Tokyo, Osaka place.
See, I feel like went to Gifu, though, I'd
be like,
lives
in the part of Japan that's
wacky.
All, like... He lives in the part of Japan that's all, like, respectable and shit, you know?
I'm in the part of Japan that's Japan. That's the thing that people need to know. Not everywhere is like Tokyo. In fact, Tokyo is one of the very few places because Tokyo is a very westernized, has a very westernized, like, subculture to it.
Tokyo is one of the very few places in Japan that's like Tokyo.
Yes. Essentially, like, you got Tokyo and Osaka, and then probably maybe Kyoto. Now, Kyoto is more, like, traditional Japan, but it's still fairly big for a Japanese city. But going back to No Man's Sky, essentially a lot of what was
Dylan
promised...
Dylan is fleeing the podcast, in case you didn't notice it. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Well, speaking of fleeing, that's kind of what the developers did. Like, as soon as the game came out, everybody had a bunch of questions saying, why did you lie? Why are a lot of these promised features not in the actual game? Why is the game so boring? Why is the game constantly crashing on my PS4 system, despite it being a console game? Hello Games and Sean Murray, they went radio silent for like 2 fucking months.
They raised up from their plates of cocaine, blood dripping from every orifice. They're like, what? Whose sky is it? We don't know.
And so, like, they went radio silent. You know, they just, like, dropped off the face of the planet outside of, like, providing an update, an update to the game every now and then that provided very insignificant updates. Like, oh, the game actually works now, or we fixed a few bugs here and there.
They turned into that girl that will not text you back.
Yes. But then, like, 2 weeks ago, I think, something really weird happened where... Out of Hello Games' Twitter account came a random tweet that was immediately deleted within an minutes, saying, No Man's Sky was a mistake.
Oh! That is some fucking, like, inside baseball. Like, that is like a collapse of that company kind of shit, where it's like, we have to give up making video games. Like, nobody in this room is ever allowed to play video games again. Because of how much of a fuck-up that tweet is. Like, it's honest and whatever, but that company is done after that. Like, destroys their credibility.
Here's where shit went weird, when it's, like, far south.
That's not weird?
No, it got even weird where it's like you got like several different websites, like Kotaku, Forbes, Polygon. They got varying emails from like the official Sean Murray's official email. They got an email from Hello Games' official email. They got like Twitter announcements from the official Twitters of Sean Murray and Hello Games. Each of them had a very contradicting story of what the fuck happened. They said one source said, "Oh, we got hacked." One said, "Oh, it was a disgruntled employee." Sean Murray himself, supposedly Sean Murray, according to his official Twitter, said he was the one that made that official tweet. So you got these contradicting stories from supposedly official sources. So everyone's wondering, like, what's going on? And it got to a point where Sean Murray's Twitter asked Hello Games' Twitter, "Hey, are you still hacked and stuff?" And then the Twitter of Hello Games said, "Oh, everything's fine. Back to work as usual." But everyone's like, why is Sean Murray communicating to Hello Games on Twitter if Sean Murray is Hello Games? He is the head of Hello Games. Why is he communicating to his own company through Twitter? Unless he's trying to make it look like there's if he's trying to promote the story that it's still a hack.
He's
so, like, was it a hack?
Called creating a paper trail in espionage terminology, where you just, like, send a bunch of letters to some kid in India where it's just like, oh, I can't be held accountable for this murder because I was sending letters to a kid in India. Like, you know, so he's creating a data trail where he's like, oh, I wasn't writing fucking weird shit on my Twitter on Hello Games. I was tweeting at my own Twitter account. Like
so
a sociopath.
So was it a hack? Was it a disgruntled employee? Was it Sean Murray himself? Again, like, after the controversy, after all these contradicting stories came out, once again, Sean Murray and Hello Games went into radio silence again. So nobody knows who is telling the truth, what is fake, what is real, what's bullshit, what isn't. It's just a complete and utter mess. Whereas, like, it's funny how, like, the game No Man's Sky, like, many people were upset at the game because it tried to pass itself off as a $60 AAA title that only amounted to roughly $20 worth of content.
Yeah, that's what
you know,
I heard.
You fly to different planets, you jump off, you take a look around, you record some animals and plants in your journal, maybe shoot some aliens, then you go off to the next, like, 50 or so planets and do the same thing over and over again.
Right. Yeah, that's the complaint
I've
heard about
it. It's essentially like Minecraft in space.
Mm. And who wants to play that?
Except, like, unlike Minecraft, the whole collecting shit and building shit is far less complex than in Minecraft.
Mm. Now, do you just, like, fly around space, or do you just, like, teleport from planet to planet, and they're like, in between you flew?
Yeah, you essentially teleport.
That's bullshit.
Because that's another thing. They try to pass it off as, oh, you can, like, there's, like, an infinite amount of space, and you can actually fly to all these planets however you want, even though everything's just really pre-rendered. They say, like, oh, these planets, they revolve around their own individual solar systems. They don't. It's just, like, a lighting system, like, to have, like, some sort of virtual sun revolve around the planets to give it the illusion that there's a day and night cycle.
Wait, there's a sun revolving around the planets?
Yeah, yeah. They'd make it say, oh, these planets, they have their own system. They, you know, everything's procedurally generated. But no, there's like a fake sun, like a lighting system that allows fake nights and day cycles to pass around the planet.
Oh, I mean, it's not a documentary. I mean, it's a video game. I mean, so I would expect
But yeah, yeah. They cheated along the way to make it look like this is a full-on thing, but
so they tried to make it sound like they made it more complicated than it really was, is what you're
exactly
saying.
Yeah,
okay,
yeah,
I gotcha. Okay,
yeah, yeah,
because for a second I was like, for a second you're like, oh, it's a lighting system. I'm like, Andres, it's a video game. Like, of course.
No, but they were trying to pass it off as, yeah, yeah. They didn't even say, like, oh, like, the planets revolve around suns. They don't. They say the moons revolve around the suns. They don't.
I see.
It's like, you know, even like way back when they had their very first trailer announced, they had these giant alien dinosaurs walking around. There are no alien dinosaurs. They say you can land on asteroids. You can't land on asteroids. They say the animals can eat each other and have their own ecosystem. The animals don't eat each other. They just randomly wander about on the planet.
Mm.
But do they have their own ecosystem?
They don't.
They have their own wandering ecosystem. Like, the ecosystem of every planet is the same. The animals don't have to eat, they don't have to fuck, they don't have to sleep. They just wander around. That's their whole lives. It's against every survival instinct of Darwinian evolution.
Are the animals at least kind of neat looking? Or
Yeah, yeah, although because due to the fact that it was only a 12-person team, there wasn't a lot of assets, and while there technically can be many numerous millions upon millions of combinations of animals you would encounter, a lot of them kind of feature the same types of, like, of assets, you know, the same arms, same legs, same faces you would start get repeated among different aliens. Another thing was also promised was, like, interstellar, like, space battle, like Star Wars level, like, space battles that you can participate and join sides in. It was like they spend one E3 presentation showing off, like, how you can say, like, oh, look at all these cool space battles, you can join sides and do whatever. None of that is featured in the game, so really people are going looking back at all these trailers and realizing not only does the game look better in the trailers than it does in the final release, but a lot of shit, a lot of animals, a lot of creatures, a lot of space battles that you see in the trailers are completely absent in the game. And in fact, there have been so many lies stated throughout the entirety of No Man's Sky's production that some people have put together like a Tumblr or a blog called No Man's Lie, showing the list of everything that Sean Murray and Hello Games has stated that was not in the official release.
I feel like a clever pun should have been One Man's Lie and just a picture of Sean Murray.
Oh, no,
like,
oh, that's what it was. That was what it was. It's called One Man's Lie.
Then that's great.
Yeah, my mistake. It's just fantastic. That some people have on YouTube, many people on YouTube has referred to the game as No Man's Lie, but the blog is called One Man's Lie.
Yeah, because I feel like No Man's Lie, that's misleading, because it's like, nobody lied, no man lied. It's like, well, no, some one man lied a lot.
So that is the craziness. That is No Man's Sky.
All right, well, D, I can already tell by looking at your vacant expression that you don't give a shit, so let me just say this one last thing, because I care slightly more about this than I did the last two stories. Still not a lot. I didn't play the game, and I don't really intend to. I was never really interested. But I do care a little bit more because I like that idea, and I'm really sick of, like, all these game companies coming out and being like, we have this great fucking idea, look at how revolutionary we are. And then they just don't make a full game. And it's like, I don't know what goes through their heads. Like, I don't know why they don't just go, well, if we put out a half-assed game, we will forever be known as the guys who put out a half-assed game. Because that's what happens to these guys now. I mean, look at that, what's that Mega Man knockoff you were talking about for a while?
Oh, Mighty Number 9. That was an embarrassment.
Like, it's just, look around you, video game designers. Like, the internet is not dumb. Like, or it's not even a matter of being dumb. It's a little dumb. It's pretty dumb, actually. But people notice shit, though. Like, nothing goes unnoticed now. So, if you fucking put out a half-assed game that you fucking lied through your teeth about prior, you're gonna get a shit reputation online. And that makes or breaks video game companies these days. So, it just astounds me. One last thing I wanted to ask you, though, about it. So, you bring us a lot of these video game companies lying to the people who they're making the video games for stories. Maybe we've talked about this before. I wanted to know, what is your personal fascination with that? Like, did you have a personal tragedy in your life where it was like a video game company did you wrong and you forever swore vengeance? Like, what?
I just find these stories very interesting, and also the fact that these stories keep getting featured on my news feed, Facebook feed.
And you're just like, well, we have to cover something on SOS later, so.
Exactly.
I see. All right, well.
I have friends who are into video games, and so that shit gets brought up on my Facebook feed. And it's like, oh, what's this? And then I end up going down this rabbit hole. Like, I wasn't even aware about No Man's Sky until, like, maybe a month before its release. And then when I found out about all this controversy, and then I decided to look into it, and I was like, wow, this is quite a show.
Yeah, I didn't know about it until after it came out, and a guy I worked with was like, oh my god, it's amazing. And I was like, is it really? And then a week later, everybody I talked to was like, it's garbage.
Was Jake one of them?
Jake hates this game. He vitriolically hates this game. All of my video game friends do.
Right. This has become like the biggest disappointment of 2016.
But I feel like they're similar to like hearing them talk though is like listening to your news stories about this though, because it's just like all they talk about is just like being shit on by video game designers, and I'm like. Is this the entire video game industry just made up of fucking liars and con artists these days? Like, what the hell happened? Like, when I was a kid, like, everything was great. Call of Duty had zombies in it. Like, that was the shit. Like nobody was pissed. Like, everybody was happy.
I don't know. Maybe it's because, like, maybe people feel like they have a more stronger connection to the people behind the video game developers than people like you and I do with the people who than the filmmakers behind the films that we watch. Maybe there's more of a closer connection because maybe video game developers, because video games are not as big as movies, they have to rely more on social media and thus trying to establish more of a connection to its fan base.
I also feel sorry, go ahead.
I was going to say, so if a video game developer were to fuck up, it hits closer to home, perhaps.
Well, I also feel like they're putting out more of a traditional product, so to speak, as it's something you go to a store to buy. So
It costs more.
Yeah, well,
so
yeah, there's that too.
There's a much greater financial investment in video games.
So yeah, I suppose.
So if you buy a bad video game, that's a waste of $60 right there. If you buy a bad console, that's a waste of $300 right there. If you waste a bad movie, it's only about like a $12 to $10 ticket you just wasted.
Yeah, there's more of a stigma attached to video games being bad, I feel, than movies being bad. I think because again, if you go see a bad movie, you're like. Usually, unless it's like a you know, Batman v Superman or whatever, but you know,
but a bad video game, it's like an interactive experience.
If a video game is bad, even if it's just a little bad, like people will vitriolically be like, "Fuck this game and the mothers of everybody who made it," like fuck them right up their dumb asses.
Uh huh. So yeah. So I guess moving on. Here's something that I'm sure you guys will be happy to hear. This is actually a very short story, but the news itself is really cool, and that is that Funimation announced that they were officially going to be distributing the English dub version of Dragon Ball Super.
Woo! Yee-hoo! I've seen
they
all
have,
of it already. Yep.
They haven't announced when they're going to release the dub, but they just wanted to let fans know that they are. It's now official.
Well, they just
that
got
super
their...
will be.
Andres, yeah. here's a news item that I don't know if you were aware of or have prepared. But there was some controversy online over the fact that Xenoverse 2 came out, and some people were not happy with Sean Schimmel's Goku Black voice.
Oh, really?
This plays into this.
So that it has cast some thought towards the super dub, obviously. Because basically what he did.
Mm-hmm.
Is he did just like a growlier version of Goku. Like it pretty much sounds like his Super Saiyan 4 voice for the most part. Maybe a little less like digitally fucked with, but just like, it's just like a bah, like that, like a, I'm going to fuck you up. Like, you know.
Which I do think if you watch Dragon Ball Super, like the Japanese version, I think that is a understandable approximation of the Japanese actress's version of Goku Black, but the lady
whose name I don't fucking know it, but that chick, her Black performance is a lot more subdued, you know. She's a lot more subdued is the word. She's a lot more like sort of unnerving. Like her performance is just sort of like, I'm gonna kill you, like as opposed to I'm gonna kill you. Like it's, I don't know. And who's to say that of course, it's entirely possible that Schimmel and the rest of the dubbing cast will watch that material ahead of doing the dub and decide to adjust his performance thusly. Goku Black was sort of a last-minute addition to Xenoverse 2 anyway, so I mean, it was sort of a rush job. But,
Have they provided any English voices to any of the Universe 6 Saga characters?
Yes, Hit is in the game.
Okay, how does he sound?
I liked his voice just fine. There were some people who didn't care for it, but I liked his voice just fine.
What did he sound like?
I don't know how to describe it. It's just like, he's just a dude, you know?
Did he sound like PyCon from Z? I'm
trying to think what PyCon sounded like.
He sounded like this! Wait. He sounded kind of like Jerry Seinfeld, but a Dragon Ball Z character. Now that I think about it, that was a poor pull. Let me think of another one. Tien. Did he sound like Tien?
That's probably a closer approximation. I think a lot of people, after watching the Japanese version of Super, would expect him to have like a deep, like almost Piccolo voice, but it's not quite that, you know?
Are you saying that he kind of hammed it up as a villain, which is what Goku Black is not? Like, Goku Black is the serious, like, put together,
no,
subdued version of Goku.
I'm talking about Hit, not Goku Black.
Oh, my bad. I'm sorry. But I was just going back to that because I didn't really I haven't heard it. I don't know what it sounds like. But is the complaint that? So I'm sorry. The complaint seems to be that it's because, you know, Goku Black is not an over the top Dragon Ball Z villain. He's very different. He has a very different kind of personality, and so does his other half, as you might say. than your typical kind of just, I'm just going to kill everything because it's fun, DBZ villain.
Okay, okay. You know what? You know what? This will help the discussion tremendously instead of me trying to describe this shit. Here's a YouTube link so you guys can hear the voices.
Oh, I was trying to avoid this. I was trying to avoid doing work.
You're asking me to avoid. I mean, avoid. You're asking me how to describe how they sound, and I can't fucking do it. So it's just like, here, fucking listen to the damn thing.
Where'd you send the link?
Through Skype.
Oh, huh. just popped up now. Okay.
Okay.
By the way, I found out the origin of the word meme. It comes from fucking Richard Dawkins.
He sounds like Steve Blum's Wolverine.
Kind of. Sean Schimmel like doing bug. Wolverine. Yeah, dude.
Yeah,
kinda.
This is Sean Schimmel doing Wolverine.
Ooh, I don't like this either. Yeah, no.
You want You're gonna die, to Bob. That badly, Namekian.
Yeah. Ew. Well, it's not. It's not that character. I mean, it's not his fault. Like, let's not pretend like this is Sean Schimmel's fault. This is. He was given a probably very bad video game script, and he was like, and they were like, just read it, and he was like, oh, evil Goku, I'll just do the Super Saiyan 4 voice. And as like
right,
an
and I don't know how much, if any, of Super that he's actually watched yet. That's why I said, I'm thinking, you know, as they get closer to actually doing the dub, they might rethink the voice, especially seeing sort of how the internet has not reacted too favorably.
Also, Hit sounds like Shadow the Hedgehog. Although
if you go to like a minute 41, you'll start to hear Hit.
Mm. I'm the ultimate life form.
Oh, I don't know how I feel about that either.
You're going down, Sonic.
Anyway, I don't think it's indicative of anything. I mean, the dialogue in all of the DBZ games is awful anyway. Like, it's unfucking watchable. Like when you see like the video game versions of the show's scenes, like when. Anything with Raccoon in the video games is unwatchable. Like, he's just like, I'm Raccoon! It's like, oh, fuck me. Somebody please stop.
You're gonna wish you wish for the DBZ abridged version?
No, I wish I was just watching the show, because I would at least be like, well, I remember enjoying this as a young man. Like, instead it's like some weird, bad, modern version of that with, like, modern voice acting, and it's like, oh, this is just painful.
When you play the story mode of Tenkaichi 3,
mm-hmm.
and you play the Dr. Wheelo level, you start out as Piccolo. And if you should choose to just kill Dr. Wheelo as Piccolo instead of like cycling through the characters and doing the story as it played out in the movie, if you just finish him off as Piccolo, at the end Piccolo goes, he's creepy. I was like, Piccolo wouldn't say that.
No,
that's not Jedi.
Yeah, no, that shit's definitely not Jedi.
Yeah, so anyways, I guess moving on, this is another short story before we go into our big three. The short story is that last week it was announced that Young Justice, the show that was canceled after two seasons on Cartoon Network and was quickly replaced by Teen Titans Go, is coming back for a third season. So there we go. For those of you who enjoyed the adventures of Robin / Nightwing, Aqualad, Speedy turned Red Arrow, and the rest of the gang, Kid Flash and everybody, then hooray for you guys. You guys get to have one more season of that good stuff. We don't know if it's supposed to be a final season or if it's going to be like a continuation if it becomes popular enough.
Is that show supposedly good?
Oh, yeah, it's really good.
I've seen,
it's fantastic.
I've seen bits of it. Yeah, it's great.
I've never watched any of it because I was like, this ain't my Teen Titans. And then Teen Titans Go happened, and I was like, oh.
It's like, there you go, you got the roster, you got the voice actors, there you go, it's better now.
I haven't seen a lot of Young Justice or the old Teen Titans cartoon, but what I've seen of Young Justice, I liked better than the old Teen Titans cartoon. But that's just me, I was never a big fan of that anyway. I know that that's like blasphemy, but...
Kind of like if you like Teen Titans, but you want to see less of that anime influence, then Young Justice is your show.
Well,
That's exactly what I liked. Mm-hmm. That's exactly what I liked about the old Teen Titans cartoon, though, is that it was like, wow, it's a DC, like, not really in the DCAU, but I always sort of considered it like a peer of like one of those shows. It's a DC animated show, but it's like got this like neat like anime influence, you know. It almost feels like watching DBZ versions of DC characters. Like that was always kind of what I liked about it.
Yeah.
Young Justice
Slade was a beast in that show. He was like
one
of the best villains from my childhood.
Yeah. The Young Justice, I would say, is very comparable in terms of, like, the style and tone. I would say it's very comparable to, like, something like Justice League Unlimited.
Yeah, it's very DCAU on purpose. They were trying to capture a little bit of that magic. But it's a different universe, though, and because of that, and because of the differences, I do think that it worked. Except their Joker is, like, the worst.
Oh, no.
Is, like, the worst. It is the worst I've ever seen. It's like... So every
is it even worse? Is it even worse than Barefoot Jamaican Joker?
Oh, no. Yes. Are you really? Fucking yes? Are you dumb? Hell yes. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to say you're dumb, but yeah, I enjoy Jamaican Joker. I can. But...
You didn't say he was dumb. You asked if he was dumb.
Oh well, I feel both ways. No, I enjoy Jamaican Joker, but Young Justice Joker. Because, okay, so let's talk about it for a second.
What is it? Is it the voice?
Is the voice
bad?
Yes. The design's not great either, though. The Joker, right? Many different ways you can do that performance. You can do creepy Heath Ledger Joker. You can do kind of serial killer stand-up comedian Joker like Mark Hamill's. You can do just crazy, weird art thief like Cesar Romero. Or you can do the, like, kind of... bank robbing, like, 40s huckster kind of Joker, like in the Super Friends cartoon. Guess which Joker
you
Young
can do. You can do disinterested gangbanger Joker.
Yeah, that good pull. But that's closer to, like, the 60s huckster Joker.
Oh, I got a video. Okay.
So that's, like, the 60s huckster Joker. And it is a bad version of that, like, 60s huckster Joker. And that's why I don't like it, because it's him going like, yeah, see, we gotta stop the Batman. And I'm like, oh my god, somebody please fucking hit this guy with a car.
I'm looking at some pictures. What'd they do to his hair?
Yeah, it's like a mix of, like, the Mark Hamill Joker and the Heath Ledger Joker.
I feel like they were going for a Heath Ledger, like laid down hair thing, instead of like a we interrupt your regularly like a spiky hair, like you get sometimes, but it's just like, he looks like Mad Mod if Mad Mod had green hair instead of red hair.
Yeah.
Like he has a mop top. Like, why?
But it's not even like a good mix of the Heath Ledger and Mark Hamill Joker, like I think the Joe DiMaggio, John DiMaggio Joker was in Under the Red Hood. Like, that was like a perfect mix of those two things while still making it its own thing. This is like...
And check out the chops on him.
Yeah.
The mutton chops.
Oh, yeah. The dude's got like major sideburn action going on.
But this guy is like just... It's a mix of all the wrong Jokers in the wrong places. Like, I don't like it. But anyway, so I like that show though. I'm glad it's coming back. It's nice to see DC again. It's nice to see DC winning for once.
And if you happen to be a big fan of the Blue Beetle, what was his name? Jaime Reyes.
Jaime Reyes, yeah.
Yeah, if you're a fan of the Jaime Reyes Blue Beetle, then the second season is a adaptation of one of his stories.
Yeah, well, here's my question. Where are they going in continuity-wise with this? Because I know that they did a time jump in that show. I never got to that point, but... Initially, it's Dick Grayson, Robin, and it's all the proto... It's all, like, the proto... It's early Teen Titans. But then they did a time jump, and it was, like, Tim Drake and Jaime Reyes.
Nightwing.
Yeah. And Starfire and all that. So.
And Static Shock.
Oh, Static was there. Cool.
They redid Static Shock.
Is this the show
with Black Aqualad?
Show with Black Aqualad. He's one of the best characters, yeah. And there's a great like rivalry between him and Robin. It's really great.
What is the origin story there? Is he Atlantean? Like
Oh, Aqualad? Yeah. Atlantean. He's a big-time Atlantean.
Okay.
Yeah. I think he's more Atlantean than that Aquaman is. Because that Aquaman's kind of just like, I'm just a cool dude, you know, I'm just hanging around. And that guy's like, no, we have to follow Atlantean law to the letter. And Aquaman's all right, dude, whatever you say.
Aquaman kind of always had that human connection, though, you know, the kind of born of two worlds thing going on. I just never realized that the Atlanteans had black people, and I guess that's just a thing now.
You think the sun rays couldn't get down there?
That's why
I thought black manta is black, so you know. Who knew?
But is he an Atlantean, or is he just a guy?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Goes down there
and fucks
with shit.
I don't know a lot about Aquaman's rogues gallery, as it turns out.
I do want to say something, but it's like a spoiler.
I think he fights a pirate at some point. I don't know.
Because I feel like if Black Manta is an Atlantean, then he wouldn't need the whole Darth Vader setup, you know?
Yeah, no, he's injured, though. He is kind of a Darth Vader type, though, because he's injured, I think.
Okay. I'm just not overly familiar with this. Yeah. That's why I was thinking that maybe Black Aqualad had, like, a different, like, origin story or something going on, because I didn't realize there were Black Atlanteans in this universe. Interesting.
He was cool, though, because, he had the
there was a whole deal going on where, like, the Atlanteans near Europe, they had to, you know, capture some of the African Atlanteans, bring them over as slaves. It's a whole historical issue there.
I thought you were being real for a second. Where you were like, there are different kinds of Atlanteans. Holy shit, that's so cool. And then I was like, oh wait, no, he's making a joke. Okay?
Are they about to plant like a wall of undersea mines to keep out the Mexican Atlanteans?
Probably, who knows, Trump.
No, they're smart enough to elect a guy that thinks, like, an underwater wall is a good idea.
You've seen Free Willy, right? Walls don't work.
Yeah. I bet you
You've seen the ending of that movie?
Yeah, I sure have. We saw it together. All right.
Yeah.
I'm excited about I do kind of care about this. I won't watch it because I don't watch anything, but I'm excited about it as an idea, so I'm cool with it. How about you, Dave?
Okay, so
me?
Yeah. Do you care?
I mean, I've never seen the show before in my life, and I don't plan on it. But you know, people enjoy it, so that's a thing. You know. Don't really have an opinion.
My favorite part about it was, and this was never developed enough to me, was the relationship between Superboy and Superman, because Superboy was a clone of Superman, and Superman
They made that a plot point for season one.
Where Superman was like, don't like this kid. He's kind of a dick, and he thinks he's my son, and he's not, and I'm Superman. I can't really be a dad, so this is kind of shit. And it was weird, because it was like, it's weird to see Batman, like, trying to get Superman to do the right thing. You know, like, that's not really usually how the dynamic works. But there's a great scene where Batman, like, has Superman in a diner, and they're having dinner or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
And they're just chilling.
Real talk.
Yeah, they're just chilling.
Yeah, yeah.
And there's just this moment where Bruce goes, the boy needs his father. And Clark just gets up, and he's like, I'll take that pie to go. It's such a great moment. I would just watch a Superman and Superboy show, though. Like, that's what I want, you know?
Mm-hmm.
That's a great version of Batman, though, too. Anyway, moving on.
Yeah,
Marvel could do some good animated shit now, you know?
Yeah, oh god, their cartoons are so bad right now.
What is Avengers
Get back to where
assembled?
You were in the 90s, Marvel. Get back to where you were.
They were! Avengers Earth's Mightiest Heroes was great, and then they fucking started Assemble, and
Is Assemble still going on?
Yeah,
I heard that's What about Ultimate Spider-Man? I heard that was getting canceled.
That is getting canceled. They're starting a new Spider-Man show next year.
Fuck me.
It looks okay.
And what about Guardians of the Galaxy? Is that still going on?
Yeah, I think so.
That was a cartoon?
Yeah. There was a Guardians cartoon, yeah. It was just it was the movie every week. That's literally all it was.
I want a fucking R-rated on Adult Swim Ghost Rider cartoon.
Yeah, that would be cool. No, but you know what though? I would rather see I'd rather see that for Blade. Like I said, I'd love to see like a R-rated like
I'd
Blade
like to
cartoon.
See. I'd like to. I would love it if that's how Marvel finally exploited their whole like horror catalog. Just make them into like really like gritty cartoons. Like,
thing
that'd
is
be cool.
though, at a certain point, it's hard to do a live action universe with cartoon series in it. Like, you know, like I think that's. That's a bit awkward.
Oh, you mean a televised cinematic universe?
Because then what do you do when... Well, I mean, you can do a separate thing. That'd be cool. Like, just do a whole bunch of, like...
Well, the anime... Yeah, I was about to say, the anime shit doesn't have to be connected to the MCU.
Oh, yeah,
like,
no,
I know Marvel has a boner for connecting things now, but, like, you don't have to. Fuck it.
No,
like,
don't connect cartoons to live action, because that's what I'm saying. It's weird. Because do you cast the voice actor as the live action version?
Funny enough, they did that with... what's her name? Huntress? No, not Huntress. The Vixen? They made an animated video, an animated, like, short that takes place within the DC television universe, except it's animated and it features one character.
That's fucking
that African-American superhero woman that was dating Green Lantern in Justice League Unlimited.
Vixen.
Okay,
yeah,
yeah,
Vixen.
She has, like, animal powers. Animated short. Yeah. They made a Vixen animated short that takes place within the Flash, Arrow, Supergirl universe.
I'm not very familiar with that world.
I guess that's fine if they never want to use that character again. Because Bill said, it would be weird because you'd be like, what, are you going to cast the voice actor? Not that it really matters, because DC has their TV and movie universes separate anyway. They didn't do the whole Marvel thing. So.
Yeah. Okay. So I guess moving on, before we get into the two big movie-related news, I did want to talk about a little bit of the YouTube, kind of like the shady YouTube drama that's been going on during the SOS's absence. The first was the whole deal with YouTube
demonetizing. I would love it if it was because we weren't there, where it's like when the SOS disappeared. When the world needed him most, it was him. Like, it's one guy. No, when Dr. Sarah disappeared.
They looked up and shouted, "I'm sure." We looked down and whispered,
"This
no.
all happened because we weren't there to watch it happen. Like, this is all our fault.
We're that fucking important,
right?"
Oh. Yeah, I'm sure we're on YouTube's radar. Yeah. Keep dreaming, buddy.
It's funny enough, like, a lot of this YouTube stuff doesn't really affect us for the most part, because we are the individuals who just do YouTube as a hobby. We don't make any money off of it, but a lot of people do, and so a lot of people were upset when YouTube
I'm not against making money off of it, though.
That's true.
It's but, still kind of bullshit.
Well, a while back, YouTube was kind of trying to do this, if you guys remember, several years ago, there was a big uproar within the YouTube community over YouTube kind of making tweaks to the copyright claim system, the copyright algorithm, to where, you know, they would have these, like, YouTube bots just, you know, scanning all these videos and, you know, slapping copyright claims because they can detect whatever copyrighted footage that you may or may not have on your videos. And so a couple of years ago, Angry Joe, he made a video where he was shouting at the top of his lungs that how, like, 20, 30 of his videos got, like, copyright claimed because of YouTube's changed algorithm. Well, a similar thing happened here, except instead of with a copyright claim, it's about demonetization, where YouTube kind of changed their demonetization system, saying, to where these, like, you know, whatever algorithm there's the YouTube's website system has, they start, like, started demonetizing videos with certain tags, certain words in the title, anything that has to do with, like, rape or news or controversial topics, were automatically, you know, demonetized. People couldn't make money off of videos that had topics that within their title, within their thumbnail, or within their descriptions, or within their tags. And the thing is, like, they had these, a list of topics you cannot talk about. YouTube put out an official list of topics that you cannot talk about unless you want to get demonetized, but the topics were super, super vague, and so people started freaking the fuck out, saying, OMG, this is the end of YouTube. OMG, I can't make a living off of YouTube anymore. Of course, that kind of died down because it was sort of a thing where you can easily, much like fighting a copyright claim, you can go back and fight a demonetization claim. So you can get your, if you make a good argument, then you wouldn't get your, start making money on your video again. But it was just a thing that showed how much of a mess YouTube's system was. And also these vague rules were kind of already there to begin with since the beginning of YouTube. Only now they started taking like action against this, which makes these very vague rules even more noticeable and more of a problem. So people thought that was going to be the end. However, YouTube came out with a program called YouTube Heroes, which allowed, rather than trying to go
is,
out...
This is the real bullshit right here.
Yeah, this is the real bullshit. Just when you thought it couldn't get any worse, then it came with YouTube Heroes, where YouTube came out with this program. So, like, rather than having hiring employees to police their website to look for, you know, inappropriate content or, you know, inappropriate behavior, they wanted to get other people on YouTube to do their work for them for free and reward them points for, you know, for essentially snitching on other people's videos. And
wait,
you can get reward. Mm-hmm.
What do the points go towards? Is it like fucking Harry Potter points? Where it's like 50
see,
points
this is what
to
happens.
Gryffindor.
It's super fucking bullshit. Like, the more points you get, like, you can, like, move up to, like, different levels, basically, and, like, the higher level you are, like, the more power you have in this system.
Yeah,
so it's super scary.
The more
essentially,
power you have on
to mass flag videos, that's the thing that got everyone afraid.
Essentially, Bill, this is what could happen. Somebody, just a regular fucking schmo like us, could join this YouTube hero shit, and get a lot of points, which, by the way, you get points for snitching on people. It doesn't, I don't even know if there's, like, it has to, like, be proven to be true. You just get a fucking point. So all they have to do is go out there, flag a bunch of shit, they get points. Eventually, they get up to this super high level, and the next thing you know, if they see a channel that they don't like, and I'm sure no one would ever use this in, like, immorally to just censor opinions they don't like. I mean, obviously that would never happen. But if they see somebody they don't like, they can pretty much just take their channel down because they can mass flag a whole shit ton of videos at once and just, like...
And you can actually, like, communicate with other YouTube heroes. So if you want to conspire against a certain channel or a certain certain group of people, you can...
and they don't care who they're recruiting. They're just like, as long as we get people,
anybody, yeah, as long as we have people to do the work for that we're too lazy to hire.
Anybody who has a fucking YouTube account could theoretically do this. Like, I don't know if you've seen. I don't know if you've seen a YouTube. I don't know if you've seen a YouTube comment section before, but these are not the kind of people you want to give absolute power to, is what I'm saying.
That's funny. Exactly. That's a funny thing. The YouTube Heroes video itself got so much shit, they disabled the comments on that video. They wanted to create a system that can control the YouTube community when they themselves couldn't control the community on their own fucking video.
YouTube, you peaked when the fucking subscribe button was red and had a little play symbol in it. Just stop. Just enough.
Oh, now there's this bullshit where, like, if you don't watch enough of a channel's content that's come out, like, you'll stop getting your subscriptions in your feed, so now you gotta go in and, like, check a little box saying, yes, I do want to get the videos from this subscription. It's almost like you have to explain to them what the word subscription means.
Look at that fucking like-to-dislike ratio, Bill.
Alright, hang on, I'm clicking on this video. I feel like I should do a blind commentary on this. It's only a minute long.
You should.
I'm gonna do it.
It's, yeah. You wanna do it? Okay, yeah, just let me know when let me know when you're at 000.
Oh, you guys wanna watch it with me? Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
I've seen this video before. Wait until you hear this bullshit, because hearing them describe it is even better, because they're trying to describe it in, like, this super sunny, look what we're doing for the community.
Yeah,
and
it feels like they're targeting this at, like, children. You know, it's like, YouTube heroes, you get to win points and get a cool bunch of cool rewards on YouTube.
Oh my god, I just saw the like to dislike ratio. Fuck me. Okay, so if you want
to be the very best, like
play,
no one ever was.
If you want to play along at home, we're watching Getting Started with YouTube Heroes. I'm not putting it in the description. You're a fucking functioning member of society. You can look it up yourself. Getting Started with YouTube Heroes. It's on YouTube Help, the YouTube channel.
For those of you who are listening, I would just like to point out that this video has just south of 30,000 likes, okay? But the dislikes are very nearly a million. It's 900,000 and something. So, yeah.
It's over 9,000. They're both over 9,000, so that's kind of...
No, it's over 900,000.
It's a weird bar to set. Okay, so here we go. I'm pressing play in 3, 2, 1, play. You. Oh, me? Really? I don't work very hard to make YouTube better for everyone.
I don't work hard at anything. What are you talking about, YouTube?
Welcome to YouTube Heroes. Is that the Death Star? When you add
this
captions
is like the
and
one,
subtitles to a video.
This is like the one good thing.
Report inappropriate videos. Or share your knowledge. Yeah, knowledge? What knowledge do you have? You don't have any knowledge.
Little one, become a hero.
Notice how they very, very tactfully avoid the word censorship.
Yeah.
Oh, this is where it gets really scary and, like, fucking
exclusive
crazy.
Exclusive workshops.
They start describing what the levels do, and when they get up to the higher ones, it's like, holy shit, that's way too much for anyone to have.
See, I don't like the little video graphics.
Oh, here we go,
propaganda.
Ass flag videos. And this is level 3. There are, like, 2 more levels.
Moderate content in the
this
YouTube
This video
community.
Feels so much longer than it really is. Like, I feel like I've been here for days.
Look, contact YouTube staff directly.
Like
we
Jeff
need that shit.
From YouTube.
Not even fucking PewDiePie gets to just contact YouTube staff directly. Like, you're going to hand that to some Joe Blow off the street and earn some points?
They were like, test new features before they come out. Hey, YouTube, this new YouTube hero shit that you're letting me test, this is shit. Like, get rid of it. Okay, so a couple things here. My rough response. One, I don't understand what the fuck they're talking about, number one. Two, who the fuck cares? Like, do you really think somebody watched this and they were like, well, shit, I'd love to become a YouTube hero. Like,
no, Bill.
Does
Bill,
anybody
that's
really
want to
put the work into fucking doing this?
That's the problem, Bill.
Bullshit.
That's the problem, Bill. See, the problem is there are people who would love to do this. You take the current, like, SJW and, like, feminazi crowd, and you hand them the ability to censor YouTube channels, they're gonna fucking, like, they're gonna hit on that shit like a fat kid on some cake, you know what I'm saying?
Yes, but I just, I guess I just don't relate to that mentality enough, because I always just go back to, who fucking cares? Like, who cares enough to just police this shit, go through every YouTube video and just be what is appropriate, what's not? And making sure everybody's aware of that. I guess from a very grand, idealistic standpoint, it's nice to live in that kind of world. But again, it's just like, it just comes back to what difference is it ultimately making? You know, what change is ultimately being affected?
My main question is, what is their standard for what is and is not quote-unquote appropriate? Like, who deems something quote-unquote appropriate or not?
It's technically YouTube, but, you know, of course, YouTube barely YouTube pulls shit like this rather than actually, you know, making a stand against what is and what isn't appropriate on their site.
Oh, please. There is just YouTube porn. Like, there's just straight up porn on there now. They stopped giving a fuck about that years ago. So.
Oh, but see, Bill, the problem is a lot of advertisers, you know, have been complaining because they don't want their video. They don't want their shit advertised on a video that's not considered, like, fucking PC and shit. So that's why YouTube has had to come up
with
weight.
About that. That's true.
Which kind of ties into the whole demonetization thing as well.
Yeah.
That's exactly why they've been doing all this shit.
See, here's the thing. Because they're
actually not profitable. They're Google's least profitable segment.
Right. They don't actually make a profit. They just make enough. They just, like, barely make back the money that they're spending to keep this website up.
YouTube?
Yeah.
YouTube is Google's least profitable sector. They haven't been doing well forever, and that's what they're trying to address. The problem is they've taken what YouTube is supposed to be, or at least what we all like it to be, which is a free open marketplace for ideas, and tried to turn it into this pansy-ass PC fucking digital Sweden.
See, but I think the solution is that they'll just make a new video streaming site that'll do the exact same thing, except there won't be any of these trappings on there. Because I feel like I've been waiting for this to happen.
There has never been a suitable alternative to YouTube. Is exactly the problem.
No. So I'm saying it hasn't happened yet. It probably won't happen for a couple of years.
You're gonna go to Dailymotion? Or Vimeo, or what was the one?
Metacafe.
Metacafe.
What's the one that all the Channel Awesome people used to use?
Blip, before that shut down.
Oh, yeah, Blip used to be. I forgot about Blip. Ooh.
That was a year ago now when it went down.
I think we talked about that on the show.
I think it was August 20th, 2015 was when they shut down.
But
yeah, and it's unfortunate, cause, you know, there are a couple of those Channel Awesome guys that I still keep up with, like the Cinema Snob and shit, and, like, there are old videos of his that are just sort of lost in the ether now because their Blip's gone and he hasn't bothered to repost them or whatever.
Well, what I was saying there was, I know that this has been a conversation that's been had for a while, like, oh, what's going to replace YouTube? But I'm saying we haven't found it yet, but it will come because of shit like this. Like, this shit will keep coming and keep you know, kind of tainting what YouTube was originally, and it will eventually get to the point where somebody will have to make something that truly succeeds at supplanting YouTube. Mm-hmm. But I think that's the inevitability here.
Then the cycle just begins again, though. Say a new site does come along and replaces YouTube. Well, then eventually it becomes successful enough that it becomes a business.
Yeah, but
and
this
all
is
of
how
pop
culture works, though. This is why TV died, though, D. Like, this is.
And then all of a sudden it has to worry about what its advertisers want. And then it starts instituting fucking Daily Motion heroes or some shit. And then, you know.
Yeah, but this cycle is what keeps all this shit new. Like, this is what makes, like, this is what causes new things to be produced in the first place. Is this cycle of just dealing with the nonsense of our fucking society. So, eventually, through that nonsense, we will weed all the bullshit out. We'll all go over to Metacafe and make our Metacafe accounts. You'll be listening to the Sons of Sarazawa podcast right there on Metacafe, and it'll all be great. This is fucking horseshit. YouTube is grasping for straws.
Make Metacafe great again.
Definitely. Fuck. I just... oh. Yeah.
This is why, like, it's like, thank fucking God we don't rely, we're not like the people who put all our bets, put all our, like, what do you call it? Put all our money in one bet, or put all our...
eggs in one
put
basket?
Put all our eggs in one basket.
Yeah, we're not the people who put all our eggs in one basket and, like, rely on YouTube as, like, our, like, sole source of income.
Yeah, no.
I ain't even got no eggs, shit.
I don't buy eggs.
So let's see, moving on into actual movie news, we know what Kong looks like in Kong Skull Island.
Oh
now.
Shit, we're talking about that now? I wasn't ready. That was the thing I was
we
most
sure
looking
do.
Forward to talking about. My God, he looks fucking great. He looks amazing.
He does. He's beautifully sexy.
I feel like the CG in the still image doesn't look quite as good as what we saw in the trailer, but I'm also thinking that it might not be completed because it was released in Entertainment Weekly and there's precedent for that.
I don't know if it's a rendering
issue or if it just doesn't look as good in like full daylight as it did in the trailer when he was all like in shadow and shit and it was like, oh, what the fuck is it?
There's a GIF image that's supposedly like a Monarch file that shows that scene where that still is taken from, but with an obvious like old timey filter over it, and it's like a kind of like a pan, like the camera's panning around him as like there's a helicopter that's flying in front of his face the first time you see it. So I think the reason why the CG is a little, you may have a problem with the CG is because actually this is like a shot, like a cleaned up shot. Like a very fast-paced camera shots that's like where everything is in motion.
I will say, and I know I shouldn't have done this, but I think
it was sort of inevitable. I was looking at it and inevitably in my head comparing it to Dawn of the Planet of the Apes, which is one of the best looking movies like ever.
Oh, yeah.
So
it's definitely not on that level of realism, and I don't think it has to be. I mean, this is a totally different thing. And of course, they're trying to achieve a different feel with this kind of design than those apes are. But I gotta say, the thing that I just really loved about this was they fucking did something different than 05. Because when I first saw that, like when you saw that image of Kong like in the smoky kind of haze, you know, that image was was a total knockoff of the Godzilla 2014 teaser poster, where it was like the soldier standing on the dinosaur skull. There was the flare going up, and you could see Kong through the smoke. I was like, I don't know how I feel about that. I'm not totally sold on that. Because I was like, it looks a little bit too much like 05. But then when I saw...
Found the GIF.
But when I saw...
the Monarch file.
But when I saw this, I was like, oh, that looks like King Kong, but it doesn't look like 05. Great.
Uh-huh.
Because they didn't go for a gorilla look. Like I'm really happy that they decided to go... We're going back to the drawing board with this and taking it back to the original 33 idea where he's not a gorilla. He's just some new species of ape that kind of looks like a gorilla. And they're making him fully bipedal, and he's got a weird-shaped head. And I think it's really fantastic. I really like the design.
It does have a very retro feel, like comparing this and the 33 Kong. He has a pronounced nose. He has like, yeah, the weird dome shape, the tiny dome shaped head.
Oh, so good.
Very,
I love it.
A large brow. Like a lot of that invokes the 33 Kong.
He looks a little more human than the 05 Kong as well.
And that's
another element of 33. Like if you hear interviews about the making of 33, it's them going, you know, they were trying to get something that looked halfway human because that was scarier, they thought. And I don't think this is doing that for horror, necessarily. This doesn't really strike me as a horror movie with Kong. Maybe a little bit. But I still think that that's a good tack to take, and I'm glad they're going back to that. And, again, this is a Kong that's going to fight Godzilla. So I think that all of the different elements that they added to it to differentiate it from what we've had in the past few Kong movies, and also to make him a character that can go toe-to-toe with Godzilla, I think it's really smart. I love how bulky and muscular he looks. I like the brown hair, looking very Toho Kong in that. Did you get a little bit of a Toho Kong vibe from it as well?
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah, yeah.
Because 33 Kong does go on all fours. Like, he does occasionally get down on all fours and walk around. But by and large, he is bipedal and walking around on two legs. Which, again, I'm glad we're getting that, too. I'm glad that we're not playing this realistically.
It's kind of funny how these Godzilla and King Kong, they're very retro-style monsters with very unique body parts, body structures. Scientifically inaccurate, but still unique body structures. And the fact that it's funny, despite these characters being very old monsters, they actually feel kind of refreshing when you compare them to many new monsters that come out nowadays. Any sort of monster you see nowadays is a very insectoid or a skinny, bony type of kind of body type, where they all kind of sort of mesh together. Everyone kind of looks like the Mutos, or like the monsters you find in like the J.J. Abrams movies, the Super 8 monster, the Cloverfield monster.
Those weird tentacle things from The Force Awakens.
Yeah, or
the
even Raptar, like
Wrath-tars.
There was a movie that came out, a movie trailer that came out this week called Gremlin. Has nothing to do with the Gremlins movie.
I almost died. I was like, what? Why aren't we talking about that? Like, holy shit, no.
But the Gremlin movie has a very Cloverfield-looking monster. It's white, skinny, bony, insect, multi-limbed monster. So seeing something like Kong and Godzilla nowadays feels like a super breath of fresh air.
Yeah, I agree. I think that comes from this mindset that really became popular from the 70s onward, which was the less you see of the monster, the better, because the our fear of the unknown is our strongest fear, and then that's how you capitalize on that and make the monster scary. So you have monsters like the Alien that came out of that. Oh, yeah, that's very Cloverfield-looking. You have monsters like the Mutos and all these other, you know, creatures, Graboids even. Like, all these very kind of... There's a lack of detail and a lack of humanity in their designs that's done to make them scarier. And I just feel like it's been played out now. Like, it's been done so much, they're not scary anymore. They're just all the same fucking thing over and over again. So I'm totally with you, man. Kong and Godzilla are a breath of fresh air. And I kind of feel like they're a bit scarier than these other monsters because there's just a certain level of terror to just something that big just being in the same frame as people. Like, I find that shot in 2014 where Godzilla's feet come down in the airport to still be very, like, oh, shit. Like, very, like, if you were there, you would shit yourself. Like, my God. Like, imagine if you saw something like that in reality, because the size of that alone is just, like, it blows your mind. Like, you cannot comprehend that. So I think that's what works in these monsters' favor, that your Cloverfield monsters and your gremlins don't, you know?
Did you guys, did both of you guys see the GIF image I sent before sending the picture of the gremlin?
The Kong one. Yeah, I saw that earlier. I don't love Legendary's, like, old film effect CG. It doesn't look amazing. And DM with you, I think the CG looks a little unfinished, but that is an awesome shot, though. It's very 2014 Godzilla, which I think is the idea. Like, and I'm a bit worried about Kong Skull Island as that as well. Are you guys a little worried that it's going to be a little too similar to 2014?
No, because I'm thinking, like, they have to learn their mistakes. They have to have learned their mistakes from Godzilla by now, where it's like, it's kind of stupid to hide the monster in the first place, especially when you have a giant fucking gorilla like Kong on an island.
I think you that... Can't, yeah. But the
I'm not worried about that.
But the trailer shows that it looks like they're going to do that, though. Like, they're going to kind of hide him a little bit. Like, you look at that shot we just looked at in that GIF, and it's the camera going through the helicopter. I mean, it's a cool shot, but I'm just saying, you cover up bits of Kong, and you see him for a second, and then we're back.
I can sort of see that. Yeah, it's kind of like the climax to Godzilla 2014, where it's like, you have the cool battle going on, but then you'd always pan down to see what the humans are doing,
well,
and you spend
yeah.
more time with the humans than you do with the monsters.
Yeah, well, and that's something that Gareth Edwards talked about in the making of, where he was like, I want the fight to feel like a sporting event being filmed, less than like a choreographed fight, because I want it to feel like the camera angles are being decided on the fly as the action is happening. That's why there's a lot of, like, in buildings and stuff, and, like, off of rooftops and stuff. So I want to see something different than that, because this is a King Kong movie that looks like it's going to take place exclusively on Skull Island. So can we please just get a straight up fantasy? Like, my God, like, sure, have the real.
I just feel like the trailer has been wise, was being wise in not showing anything. Honestly, I feel like we're gonna get plenty of Kong in the movie. I just don't think that they were wanting to reveal. It's also possible that they didn't have very many shots of him.
That's true.
That's what I'm hoping. Yeah, that's what I'm hoping.
You gotta remember this was a Comic-Con trailer. It's a bit more substantive than this, but it's sort of like that first teaser trailer for Force Awakens where we really didn't get anything, and closer to the movie they released the trailers where it's like, bomb, here's all the plot points. Like, they're sort of doing a similar thing with Rogue One, which gets on my nerves, but
I haven't seen the last two trailers.
I shouldn't have watched the last two trailers because they they told me too much. The international trailer kind of killed it for me.
Trailer too, I was like, oh, this is great, but oh my God, why'd you show me that? That last official, like, American trailer was really good, though.
It was a good trailer. So, ladies and gentlemen, in a shocking turn of events, David Joshua Hernandez is here.
Oh my God.
Bill, you have a mullet?
I do have a I love how that's the first thing he says. Yeah, I do have a mullet. What do you think? I'm going 90s Superman style.
What do I think? I think this is a potential for dank Bill memes.
I was going to say before, I was like, shouldn't have gotten a mullet in the era of the dank Bill memes page on Facebook. Because
Bill, you shouldn't have got a mullet in any era.
Fuck off. Bill,
No, no, here's a meme. David, I want you to do this. It's like how I think I look compared to what I actually look. You show a picture of 90s Superman. You show a picture of 90s Superman with a mullet and the black suit, and then just show a picture of Bill right there.
Wait, is there even a picture of Bill, like, the way he is right now?
No, I haven't taken a picture of the mullet yet, and I'm
Bill,
not...
take a picture.
Fuck off. I'm not giving you fucking ammo. You can get a picture yourself.
When you had that long hair, like, vaguely Gene Wilder-esque thing going on, I was like, all right, I can dig that. But the mullet, I'm like, ah.
I love it, man. You guys can suck a dick. David, so we're talking about Kong Skull Island. What did you think of finalized Kong design that we got to see?
I'm digging it, honestly. I don't know if it's just me, but I see hints of not only the 1933 King Kong, but also the 1962 Toho Kong.
Yeah, that's what I said,
It's a total mixture of everything. Like, I was going to say this before, but I had to BRB. It's such a great little hybrid of, like, all three of the Hollywood Kongs that we've had, because it's, like, 33's face straight up with 05 skin texture on, like, 76's body frame. Like, he has 76 proportions. Like, it's perfect. I love it.
Yeah, no, definitely. I think that's definitely a good way to put it. Oh, shit, you took a screen cap, didn't you? That is a shit picture. You can't even tell that's
exactly
a mullet.
Exactly.
Please send me that picture.
But you can't even tell that that's a mullet. Like, I just look like... this looks like I have my... my hair slicked back.
David, I want you to Photoshop that over an image of Billy Ray Cyrus. specifically during the Achy Breaky Heart video, which I've never seen, but I assume is just amazing. And
is there even a video for that? Was that made at a time where video was a thing that we had access to as a species?
Yes.
That's a great picture.
It is not a great picture. You can't even tell if that's a mullet. People are going to be criticizing your dank memes.
Bill, you have a mullet. Bill, you have a mullet. You will never have a great picture again. It's time to accept that.
Y'all are just jealous. You didn't think of it first.
You could have got a mohawk and it would have looked better.
Fuck, are you dumb? Like, did you just said that? Like, you are fucking crazy if you think that. All right.
No, because then at least you could have pulled off, like, oh, I'm edgy. But instead, you're doing the whole, they're just in the front, party in the back. Bullshit.
Yeah, exactly. I'm having a great time, man. My ears are so warm. Fuck off.
This and your newfound love of crappy beers, Bill. You're slowly but surely turning into a King of the Hill character.
What do I have a love of crappy beers? I sometimes drink Bud Light. I had a Bud Light yesterday. That was pretty great. It was pretty great. I like Bud Light.
Were you about to say yesterday, all New Yorker?
What?
Were you about to say yesterday, all New Yorker and stuff?
I don't know what that means, but okay, sure.
Yesterday. You were about to go all New Yorker on us.
He's got to develop a trailer trash accent to go with his mullet.
I want to talk about King Kong. Shut up. So I want to talk about the character.
Isn't your mullet basically King Kong?
Fuck off. I want to talk
it's
about
hairy,
the
right?
I want to talk about the characters. David, your fucking balls are hairy, and they don't deserve to be called King Kong.
Bill, why do you know that?
I slept in a hotel room with the man. I know. Trust me.
Why are you aware of the fact that Gorizard is not one of those?
One better picture
trust me,
coming up.
I know what all of your fucking balls look like. Trust me.
How do you know that Dave's not one of those, manscaping motherfuckers?
Because I saw them. I fucking lifted up the covers and I was like, I know now.
But we slept on a different bed. Or is this a South Park situation?
I woke up in the middle. I set my alarm to wake me up in the middle of the night just so I could go check out what was going on.
Bill was going to look at Andres' balls, but he couldn't get past the snoring.
I knew what they looked like. I can sense that. I can sense what Andres' balls look like.
Bill's all right, superpower.
I want to talk about the characterization a little bit because I'm really, really interested to see what we get. There was a New York Comic Con viral marketing map of Skull Island that they put up, which shows how fucking big the island is. There was like a weird creature buried under it. Who knows? I think that might be Rodan. It's not, though.
It's shaped like a skull.
Yeah. But there was, like, some writing on it that was talking about, like, some kind of plant life or whatever. But more importantly, it was, like, island god, adolescent, fucking roar of fury, of fire and whatever. And a lot of people were speculating, is that talking about Godzilla? Are they going to Skull Island to look for information on Godzilla? No, they're talking about King Kong, guys. Calm down. But that does definitely bring up an interesting point in terms of adolescent. There's been a lot of talk about, are we going to get kind of a young King Kong in this movie? Because this is set in the 70s. And this is the Kong, presumably, unless he dies and there's another one, that's going to fight Godzilla in 2020 when they make that movie. So is this the young version of that Kong, where it's like it's the early years of that Kong, you know, obviously 40 years before he's going to fight Godzilla? So are we going to get a younger Kong in this movie, like a teenage Kong?
Or does this Kong have a red-headed bride and a small child, and the small child survives at the end?
I think that we're going to get one of those two. I think this is either going to be, like, a teenage King Kong, like, before he becomes king, which I think is, based on all of the marketing I've seen, that seems to be more of the idea. Like, there was, like, one thing was, like, Kong before he became king, or whatever. So I think that that's more likely what we're going to get. But if we also...
Before he was blue and fought robot dinosaurs.
Yeah.
Before he got a mullet.
Yeah.
I want to see Mullet Kong now.
I do too. 90s Kong.
I got to know if there's some picture of that already.
Oh, God. Mullet Kong. King Mullet. Somebody probably made, like, Donkey Kong with a mullet, so you can kind of just approximate that. But anyway, so what was I going to say?
I put in Mullet King Kong and all I get is Billy Mitchell from the guy who has the King Kong record.
Yeah, he had a mullet.
His mullet. Wow. He's got the king of mullets right there.
Fuck off. Mine's better.
No,
it's not.
No, this dude's like the Super Saiyan 3 of mullets.
Oh, okay, never mind then. I can't compete with that. What was I
going to say? You ain't on them Super Saiyan 3 levels of mullet, Bill.
I can't compare to that. That's not really... Yeah, alright, that's a different kind of mullet, but yeah.
This isn't even my final mullet.
Yeah. See, he's gotta get a I got it really chopped in the front. Like, I gotta let it grow out a little bit before it's gonna look really, like, good. He's got like the full lush kind of locks going, you know, like he's got it all the one on the side and shit. I'm very jealous. Anyway, adolescent Kong though. Oh, well, let me say this. So the other possibility that you mentioned was, we have King Kong's dad in this movie and Kong is like the son and you've got his mother and shit, which is obviously closer to, the King of Skull Island book that this seems to be kind of based on a little bit. So, I don't know, which one would you guys prefer? Kong as a little kid and his parents die and he's the last of his species at the end? Or would you prefer this being a teenage version of King Kong?
I'd like to see a teenage version of King Kong just to see, like, if he's awesome this at this point in his life, just imagine how much more awesome he'd be 40 years down the line.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I would prefer that version because I'd like to see an old grizzled Godzilla go up against an old grizzled Kong. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Which is exactly what we're going to get with Godzilla.
What?
Nice. I said, that's
exactly what we're going to get with Godzilla vs. Kong in 2020.
I hope so. I hope so. Because I don't know, like, I don't like the idea of, like, Kong being all young, hung, and full of cum and shit, and Godzilla's, like, this fucking ancient fucking thing. Like, Godzilla's millions of years old.
Whoa, wait, so if Kong is basically a teenager...
Yeah.
In film, so does that mean that he's growing more by the point they reach Kong versus Godzilla?
He's gonna have to, because he's only 160 feet tall in this. He's only, like, the size of, like, the original Godzilla. So he's going to have to grow at least a little bit.
I heard he was 100 in this version.
Point is, he ain't big enough to be fighting 350 feet tall legendary Godzilla.
That mullet might be.
The mullet might give him the extra height.
You guys think this version of Kong is going to have lightning powers?
I was about to bring that up. I kind of hope
lightning
so.
Lightning powers or go home.
No, he
could channel the electricity through his mullet.
No, I mean, you guys don't want that, right? You guys don't want an electrified mullet. I would like that for myself.
Maybe.
I would like that for myself so I could fucking whip you guys in the face with it for making fun of my mullet. But I don't want Kong to have that.
What's got to happen is Kong dies, right? And then he comes back to life, but he doesn't have his lightning powers anymore, but he does have a mullet.
Well, no, wouldn't it make more sense if he got the lightning powers after he was brought back to life? Like Frankenstein shit?
No.
Oh, I'm sorry, okay. You're the authority here on what makes sense.
But the mullet makes sense. He goes into a coma for 40 years, he wakes up, he has the mullet, and he's ready to take on Godzilla.
Yeah, that's perfect. That makes, like, as much sense as you could possibly ask a mullet to make.
We're talking about Kong having a mullet. Nothing makes sense anymore. We're talking about mullets as if they're a good thing for society.
Off. They're a great thing for society. I have the best mullet. I'm making mullets great again.
What would young 5-year-old Bill think if you went back in a time machine and he realized he had a mullet in the future?
He would be like, oh my god, I'm still alive. What a fucking miracle that is. That would be enough for me. I'd be like, oh, I have a mullet. That's just icing on the cake. I look like 90s Superman.
You have a strange definition of icing.
All right, well, does anybody have anything else they wanted to add about awesome-looking mulletless Kong?
Don't fucking hide him away.
Yeah, please. That's fine for the first, like, half hour. But after that, I want to see some shit. I want to
see... we already know he's going to be smacking that helicopter out of the sky. The moment he does that, the moment he makes that big, great reveal... Don't pull the Jaws shit.
See, because that helicopter scene is clearly supposed to be like a rough reference to the plane swatting down scene in 33. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering if... I'm hoping that that's towards the beginning of the movie, though. Like, when they first fly in.
Like, it's Jurassic Park 3, you know, they were in the plane and then the Spinosaurus, you know, bumped into the plane and it ended up crashing. It's like, well,
no,
fuck,
you act like he
here.
Did that on purpose, though. They ran that dinosaur over. He was like, fuck me, are you kidding me? Like, I never really thought about it until recently. Like, the Spinosaurus in Jurassic Park 3 is attacking the people with the vitriol that he is because he wants fucking revenge. Like, he's fucking pissed that they fucking hit him with a goddamn plane. Alright, anybody else have anything else they want to throw out about Kong?
I would just like to say that I think my favorite thing about this design is the fact that it doesn't have a mullet.
Oh, this is going to get real low real fast. I'm going to have to cut this mullet off in the midst of the podcast to get you
fuckers.
Oh no,
this is the title of this episode, Bill.
Mullet for Kong. That's too similar to mullet for Superman, the hashtag.
No, man, this is hashtag mulletgate right here.
Mulletgate. Alright, sure.
No, it's gotta be make mullets great again.
Yeah, okay, I'm about that. I've already made that's mullets great again.
They would have had to be great in the beginning.
All right, Andres, rock us with your last news story so I
last
can
news story.
Murder Dylan and we can be done with this podcast forever.
Okay, we finally got, during the time of our absence, both before and after the Shin Godzilla review, we've had...
I can't wait for the inevitable chapter in Bill's autobiography that Andrew's writing about the mall.
I'm really mad that Andrew's writing that now because he's like, Bill ripped off my mullet, he saw my mullet, and he just wanted one. He said that it was because of 90s Superman, but he's fucking lying, and I'm like...
What if that's how he wrote it? Because he's writing it in your voice. What if he wrote it as like, I fucking stole that Andrew guy's hairstyle, ain't I cool guy?
Like, I would be like... All right. Because I don't care about anything. I'll just accept anything. Like, you guys are making fun of my mullet. I don't really care. Like, I'm not going to get it cut just because you guys are making fun of me. That's too much work. Like, I don't care.
I mean, maybe we're wrong. Maybe the chapter will be very mullet positive because he's a fellow mullet brother. But
that's not the point. The point is, I don't want to... See, I'm not... I don't care if he says that my mullet is negative. Again, I don't give a shit what you guys think about my mullet. I give a shit about him saying that I stole the mullet from him. That's what I give a shit about.
See, you give a shit about your mullet's reputation.
I want my mullet to be exclusively my own fault. That's what I want, you know?
Okay, so if Andrew's listening, that's definitely how we should write it then, because that's the only angle he can work that will actually offend you.
I hate you. Giving this kid ideas and shit. All right, Andres, is the last news story... Is it the Power Rangers trailer?
It's the fucking Power Rangers trailer. It's the Power Ranger... It's the Power Rangers trailer, the toys, and the Zord posters, and the fucking Megazord.
Oh, yeah, we got to... Oh, I forgot that happened, too. We have a Megazord.
That piece of shit fucking sad-ass excuse for a giant robot.
Well, let's break it down chronologically. So first, we got the Zord posters. That was the first thing. I was fine with that. I thought that was cool.
Actually, wouldn't the first thing be the reveal of the Power Rangers suits, or was that before we went on hiatus?
We talked about that like a year ago.
Okay. I don't remember when that dropped.
It wasn't a year ago, but we talked about it on the show.
I couldn't remember if we had covered it or not.
Yeah, we did. So the Zord posters, I liked them. Then there was some controversy because like the Yellow Rangers poster had like some
The tweet that was attached to the poster said it's like, we don't need a license to drive this thing. Along the lines of that.
Yeah.
And people got offended because for those who don't know, the original actress who portrayed the Yellow Ranger, Trini, she died in a car accident that was caused by another car driver who was a drunk driver.
I really doubt that was even remotely what they thought of.
Why would they do that? Like,
the fans making a very vague connection that still kind of struck a chord with fans. The actress Ranger died in a car crash due to a drunk driver, and now you're saying, oh, we can drive these things responsibly. It's a vague connection, but as soon as it was made, people could no longer not see it.
I mean...
See,
on one hand,
that's even dumber than what I thought you were going to say. I thought you were going to say people were offended because the original Yellow Ranger actress was Asian, and maybe it was a comment about that whole stereotype about Asian women not being good drivers or something.
Oh, that's so much funnier, though. Because the car accident thing is sad, but that's funny.
Which, to be fair, I mean, you know, there was an accident.
She wasn't even the driver!
Oh...
She and her friend died, I think.
That's how bad of a driver she is. No.
Shots fired.
Oh, my God. I'm so sorry, Miss Twang.
Shots fired for the mullet.
Oh, my mullet gives me dark powers.
You don't have to apologize.
It's like that Halloween film. It's like that Halloween special from The Simpsons. The hair makes you evil somehow.
Yeah. Oh, boy. That was fucked up. I apologize. No, I don't. But, you know, it was pretty funny. So next we had the trailer, I think.
Bill had to grow...
I do want to say the Zords.
Bill had to grow his hair out to become evil because he couldn't grow facial hair.
True.
I gotta say, I wasn't thrilled by the Zords themselves, even though we got a few, like, only snippets. Like, we saw, like, the Tyrannosaurus's, like, tail, or the Triceratops's face, or the Sabertooth Tiger's back leg. At that point, I wasn't a fan of the aesthetics that they were going with. It was always already seemed like it looked like a very abstract, very overly complicated Transformers-esque sort of deal going on.
They look like McDonald's toys to me. Like, they all look like they're small, they're squat, they're compact. They look like toys you get from McDonald's.
Yeah, yeah, and just like the toys, they barely look like what they're supposed to be on screen.
Yeah, yeah, that's a good... Exactly. Yeah, the Zords aren't great. They're okay, though. Like, I look at that and I'm like... Fine, whatever. I can live with
like,
that.
Like the Triceratops, he looked like the most recognizable. It's like, yes, I can tell that's a Triceratops. But even then, you look at the Triceratops, he's got a bunch of holes in his skull, a lot of unnecessary detail to overcomplicate things. It's like, why?
See, they saw the trailer for Kong Skull Island. They saw the Triceratops skull. They're like, that's our mark. That's what we gotta go for. Tweak the CGI now. This is what the kids want.
Apparently, considering how much money those Transformers movies still make.
So why don't we talk about the trailer itself, then? We can talk about the Megazord in a minute. I really liked it. Like, especially the first time. Like, going back, I'm kind of like, yeah, it's fine. But, the first time I was like, wow, this looks good. Like, this looks kind of well-written. The acting looks solid. I'm glad I got...
Are you talking about the trailer?
Yeah.
Okay. See, the thing about me with the trailer was, up until like halfway through the trailer, it's a remake of The Breakfast Club, which is weird.
Yeah, I heard a lot of that. There was a little bit of Chronicle in it, you know.
It's very apparent that they're ripping off Chronicle. But just The Breakfast Club thing is so apparent. They're like there for Saturday detention and shit, and there's like a staircase, and like it looks like the Breakfast Club.
Any of you guys get like a hint of like, in terms of like the color, like kind of like the bland, grayed out color palette, it kind of gives you a bit of a Twilight feel with a tiny hint of Amazing Spider-Man with the whole very attractive people getting bullied when they really shouldn't be in real life?
Yeah, there was a little bit of that.
Do we have a Vulcan skull in this movie? And if so, were they revealed?
We got two female bullies.
We got a ginger bully who bullies the blue power.
The Blue Ranger.
Yeah, for lining up colored pencils in a certain order. Like, what the fuck?
Maybe he's got obsessive compulsive disorder.
I'm more just like a guy just walks up to him and just like slams his hand down on the table and fucks it up. I'm like, What is that? Like, that's the worst bullying I've ever seen. Like, you're not funny. You're not, like, making yourself feel better. Like, you're just a shit bully.
Right.
Kind of like Vulcan
Skull. To be a good bully, you should either be funny or actually fuck the other person up, like, physically. And he did neither of those things.
Fucking he tried to do the last thing.
Advice for children from Dylan McCandless. Do you guys think they're going too far with the gritty angle?
Possibly.
I think definitely maybe. based on that scene where Kimberly gets bullied. Because
there is potential here to go either way.
Yeah, I think I'm not saying that that's bad. I'm not saying going gritty with Power Rangers is bad inherently. No, I think that that's a cool tactic to take. It's fucking 5 years too late. Yeah. They should have done this in 2010 when the Dark Knight was popular.
The thing is, like, for me, I'm someone who likes dark, gritty stories. That's sort of like a thing that appeals to me. I mean, I call myself kaiju noir for a reason. But I can tell that other people were really not digging the dark, gritty approach because a lot of people are sick to death of that style of storytelling. Like, yeah, like you said, Bill, like 5 years back, people got tired of that storytelling. Kind of like that sort of style kind of went the way of the dinosaurs when, like, Iron Man came out and kind of made things more brighter and less serious.
Well, it just fell out of fashion, really.
And while
thanks in part to Marvel and also because DC, which, you know, does that sort of more gritty approach, hasn't had a good movie since The Dark Knight.
Oh, yeah, and we just got off of Batman v Superman, which is about as dark and gritty as you can get, and people hated that. So to have something come out so soon that looks like it might be copying that style might be a very bad choice.
But, it's not even this... the style itself that's the problem. Because, again, I think Dark Power Rangers, there's a lot to be done there. But where I kind of draw the line is this very, like, superficial darkness, this very superficial grittiness. For instance, Kimberly cutting her hair shorter just to spite her bullies. Like, what? Like, is that a thing that teenagers do that I was just never privy to? Like, that was the moment where I was like, this is kind of devolved into parody. Like, this is kind of devolved into self-parody. Like, playing a Power Rangers Dark and Gritty reboot straight, I was on board with. But when she's cutting her fucking, like, lengths off just to look kind of meaner and grittier, like, I don't know, man. Like, that didn't play for me.
If you're a bully and your victim can overpower you by cutting their hair, you're doing it wrong.
Yeah, exactly. So, I wasn't really about that element of it. But I'm surprisingly happy with the cast so far. Again, I'm happy they casted no names for the Power Rangers. I think that was a smart move.
The Pink Ranger, she looks like Amy Jo Johnson.
Yeah, the rest of them are different ethnicities except for Jason. Like, Jason and Kimberly are the only two that are the same ethnicity, I think.
Because they switched. They made Blue Ranger black now.
Black Ranger Asian, and they made Yellow Ranger a Latina.
Well, they basically cut Zach out. They turned him into Billy, and then they just started with Adam, is pretty much what they did. So, I'm okay with that. I was more on board with that anyway, because a lot of people are like, Adam is a cooler character than Zach. And I'm like, fuck off, Zach is way cooler. He's a hip-hop dancer. He knows Zach Fu or whatever that fucking
No, hip-hop keto.
Okay, right. That was an even better name. Come on, Zach Fu is great, though.
And this is why Bill doesn't write for the Power Rangers. Anyway,
I'm sorry, because my writing is so much lower than hip-hop Aikido. You guys are dicks.
When the only example you pulled out was Zach Fu, yeah.
That is a Power Rangers Jungle Fury joke, I feel. What else, though? So we don't really see any Power Rangering whatsoever. Yeah, what's going on? Dark and grittiness. Rita's, like, showing up at the Power Rangers' houses and, like, grabbing them by the throat. I loved that, though. Because why the fuck she didn't do that in the original series is beyond me. She knows all their identities. She's constantly sending monsters to, like, the juice bar
Bill, they don't have the stock footage for that.
I know, but they should have made it just so they could do that. I'm glad that we just start there. I'm not sold on Elizabeth Banks' voice yet. I'm sure it'll grow on me, because I think that her performance is likely to probably be one of the best things in the movie. But she sounds like she's doing too much of, again, like a parody kind of voice of Rita Repulsa. So she's got to make it her own. So I'm sure that she will. I just got to see it first. And I still don't like that design. That Rita design is shit.
Mm-hmm. Funny enough, she mentioned that she has killed other Power Rangers before.
Yeah.
And last week, we got confirmation of another actress who is casted to play a past Yellow Ranger.
Interesting. So there are Power Rangers still alive in the present day. I thought the idea was supposed
to... Or maybe she's a flashback.
Or she could even be...
This is very late into the production.
She could appear as some sort of, like, force ghost through, like, the morphing matrix or whatever. Like,
that's true. That would be cool. I'd be about that. I was going to say, though, like, what if they did, like, a new version of Scorpina and she was a past, like, Yellow Ranger because she got the yellow in the armor and shit. So what you do is you have her be in stasis like Zordon and Alpha. When the Rangers wake up them, which is clearly what happens in the trailer... They wake her up, too. And at first, she's like, oh, I'm a past Power Ranger. I'm your friend, and I'm going to train you guys. Then it turns out she's been working for Rita the whole time, and she fucking double-crosses them.
Well, see, this actually brings up a huge question that I have about the production. Are we getting any other villains except Rita? Because all we've seen is Rita. Are we going to have any Scorpina? Are we going to have any Goldar?
They confirmed Goldar. Goldar has been confirmed.
There's going to be some Finster in there, you know? Are we getting any of that shit?
We have to get Finster. You can cut out Squat and Babu, but definitely you need Finster. He's an essential part of the plot.
Like, here's also, something that was.
Is she going to be creating monsters in the movie, or is she just going to be fighting them herself? Like that seems kind of vague.
Why would they need the Megazord then?
I don't know.
I guess to fight Goldar. In the first episode of Power Rangers, they fight Goldar in the Megazord.
She could make Goldar's monster grow, you know. Questions. Like, I don't know why they didn't do Zed. I mean, I know he wasn't there in the first season, but, you know, just go for it, man. Everybody loves Zed.
Apparently they want to have, like, they want to make, like, six movies or something.
Oh, I saw that. It's like, we'll make seven sequels. It's like, just start with the one, guys.
If this movie ends with, like, an after-credit sequence where, like, Zed pops up, I'd be so fucking happy.
He has a green candle with him.
Yes. Oh, they gotta do Green Ranger in a sequel, right? get an actual Native American guy.
Isn't Jason David Frank, isn't he Native American? His character?
He might be at least partially. I don't actually know that for a fact. Mm. I just know that the character is supposed to be part Native American or something, or maybe that just came from the fact that the actor was. I don't know. That's actually a good question. Bill would be able to answer it, but he went to pee.
All right. There was something that was brought to my attention by Denny, who I made a video covering the recent news about Power Rangers over on my channel. Denny, being Denny Roth, aka Draco Rollin on DeviantArt. He mentioned to me that if you remember back when they were marketing Godzilla 2014, they put Bryan Cranston all over that marketing, even though he was not a big part in the movie itself. Here, he's in the movie, we know, as Zordon, but we see no sign of him at all in this trailer, nor any of the marketing so far. So I kind of find it funny that we have a reverse 2014 thing going on here.
Yeah, that's true. Where is fucking Zordon?
Yeah.
Where's Alpha 5? We have a casting for Alpha 5.
That is true, yeah.
Damn, I can hear you guys coming out of my headphones from my staircase. That is fucking insane.
That's great. Bill, is Jason David Frank part Native American, or was that just the character, or was the character not?
I'm pretty sure he is also half Native American, but I'm not sure.
Mm. You know, it's kind of funny that many people give the first season shit because for making the Black Ranger black and the yellow, and the Asian Ranger yellow. They made the Native American into a Red Ranger, multiple Red Rangers.
Yeah. Well, there's not as much stigma attached to that because he's the leader, so it's like, you know, it's progressive either way.
True. Funny enough, I didn't realize this, but it was like Steve Cardenas, the guy who played Rocky.
At least they didn't get a Jewish guy to be the Green Ranger.
That's good. I didn't realize that Rocky and the actor who played him, they're both like half Mexican descent. So he had a half Mexican Red Ranger.
He wasn't the leader of the Power Rangers, though, at that point.
True, and he was downgraded to the Blue Ranger in Turbo. Yeah. No, in Zeo.
In Zeo, yeah. He was he got downgraded to fucking in a wheelchair in Turbo.
That's a pretty big downgrade.
You could say that. Do you guys ever see that scene where he actually like broke his fucking spine or whatever? He goes flying out of a boxing ring. It's hilarious.
Yeah, I saw that movie on VHS numerous times.
I saw it on DVD, dude. I saw that in pristine quality, like the best quality you could fucking get.
Please tell me he was boxing against a young werewolf Jason Bateman.
No, he was practicing for a karate tournament, of course, as they always are. And
he broke his spine practicing?
Yeah, it's great.
Yes.
He gets frustrated because they're like, oh, Rocky, you're not doing good. You're doing like shit. And he's like, ooh. And he just does this kick and he misses. And he goes like flying like 15 feet in the air like, and just goes outside of the ring. It doesn't make any sense whatsoever. David, you've been quiet, though. What did you think of the Power Rangers trailer? Is he BRB? He's BRB, isn't he?
He might be. He probably is. BRB. Yeah. He BRB'd at the same time you did, but he didn't come back yet. Or ever.
He doesn't get an opinion then. So what did you guys think of they have superpowers outside of the costumes? Like the power...
That was okay.
The power coins give them powers.
At first I was kind of like, I don't know, because, you know, the regular Mighty Morphin Kids never, or at least it was never expressly stated that they had superpowers, even though they were able to take down putties in their civilian forms.
Yeah.
But, I don't know, because civilian powers as a concept didn't really become a big thing until, like, what, Dino Thunder?
Ninja Storm?
Okay, that was close.
All right, here's
but,
my...
But the idea grew on me, because, I mean, you have the benefit of making a Power Rangers movie, you know, 20-something years later. I'm okay with you incorporating aspects from later shows. Why not?
Yeah, well, the reason they did it is totally sensible. Andres just killed the bug. He's a badass. I get why they did it. It doesn't make any sense for, like, the ones that don't have martial arts training, which is probably... It looks like might be all of them in this version. To be able to fight just because they have the powers. So they have the strength and the agility and all that. So I think the idea then is that when they morph, it just concentrates it and focuses it and makes them more kind of fine-tuned fighting machines. Mm-hmm. But even still, I do think that there is a certain degree of cheapening to the morphing. And this is something Linkara talks about in his History of Power Rangers videos. That it cheapens the morphing a bit. Just like you're putting a costume then on, like just over like a super strong person. It makes Power Rangers feel less unique and less kind of derivative of its source material.
The only way you could really avoid that though is to never have a fight outside of the costumes. Really,
I would have been okay with that.
It makes sense in like Jew Ranger because they're not just teenagers, they're like fucking ancient warriors, so like they fight outside their costumes sometimes.
And in the case of the original series they were all like people with several with varying degrees of experience with martial arts.
Because that's the difference with this version, is they're not chosen to be the Rangers, they just fucking, it's happenstance, they just stumble upon it.
Another comparison to the Amazing Spider-Man.
You
could argue that maybe there's still some sort of, like, choosing involved, just less Zordon saying, hey, you guys are going to do this thing, and more like predestination and, like, destiny and whatnot.
I kind of hope that it turns out that they just kind of stumble upon it. In fact, I think that the idea might be...
Because I never thought the idea really made sense anyway, where Zordon, like, takes some random teenagers and hey... You want to fight some monsters? And they don't immediately run screaming from the giant head in the tube. They're I'll fight some monsters.
Of course not. He asks for five teenagers with attitude. He finds five teenagers with the smallest amount of attitude you could have asked for.
Yep. I really hope that this movie at least ups the attitude. That's my main...
That's the whole trailer. Is like, we've got attitude now. Like, that's clearly the whole idea. And I'm about part of it, but again, Kimberly cutting her hair is dumb. And putting on a leather jacket. Also... romance between her and Jason, it'll be interesting once they do throw Tommy in, because that'll throw a little wrinkle into that relationship. But I don't know, man. It seems very cliche. Like, oh, of course the two white people on the team are going to get together.
Right? Of course.
But yeah, I don't know. I'm not totally sold on that yet. Maybe there'll be a nice little romance between Billy and Trini, too. Who knows? But yeah,
or so Zach.
Or Zach.
I mean, they want to be very progressive.
Yeah, who knows? David.
No, Andres, we got to put all the brown people together.
David, did you have anything you wanted to say about the Power Rangers trailer?
Before I do, can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Because I just logged in.
Unfortunately.
Yes, we can hear you, David. We can hear you now.
In regards to the Power Rangers trailer, I liked it. I really liked the direction they're going with. But I have quite a few fears.
Okay.
I'm afraid this is going to go in the direction of Josh Trank's Fantastic Four.
Yeah, that's a good comparison.
Because I remember loving the trailers for Fantastic Four.
Uh-huh.
I loved the approach that they were going with, and then the movie came out, and I was like, damn it. And I'm afraid this might happen with Power Rangers, because it has the potential for that.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But at the same time, it also has the potential for the opposite. It could be, you know, something great, or it could be the worst thing in the world, like Fantastic Four.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. I see what you're saying.
Yeah.
But I
like I said, this could easily go either way.
Definitely. Either way, it's definitely going to be divisive, because I think that a lot of hardcore fans are just going to hate it on principle.
Mm. Which I don't understand why, because Power Rangers itself is a fucking remake of Jew Ranger.
Yeah,
but people didn't grow up with Jew Ranger. People only identify with Power Rangers solely.
Yeah.
And
it's bound to be better than the last two theatrical movies. I mean, let's be real. Don't you think? Like,
we could always go back to that Megazord.
Yeah, at least that's true.
At this point, I don't even know which Megazord is worse.
This one kind of looks least, like that Megazord, though.
Yeah, yeah. It doesn't have a face. It's silver. It's skinny. The colors are kind of all random, all over the place. It's shocking how many of the same mistakes they made with this robot.
Actually, now that I think about it, okay, it is a distinct possibility that this movie might not be better than the first Mighty Morphin movie. However, it's got to be better than
Turbo. Because it's going to be longer, so it'll definitely be better than Turbo, but it's going to be longer than the first Power Rangers movie,
which was a nice brisk
90 minutes.
At least, like, with the first movie, as bad as it is, there's a bit of a nostalgic charm to it for people like us.
Yeah, I mean, it's a 90s fantasy movie, so, I mean, it's got all kinds of weird shit in it that's entertaining.
That would have been nice, because Lord knows we haven't had a lot of whimsical fantasy stuff recently.
No, we're building to that very slowly again. Star Wars was kind of like, oh, people still kind of like that. So we'll get back there soon enough, I feel, but...
Yeah, but,
this
like, Power Rangers
definitely
seemed, like,
not
perfect...
it.
Yeah, Power Rangers would have been the perfect, like, fantasy, whimsical stuff you could have gone back to.
Definitely.
Yeah, I always thought the Power Rangers would probably be served best if they took, like, an Avengers tact with it, but no, whatever.
Oh, yeah, totally.
Again, I see why they're making this, but it's too late. Like, I mean, this trend has come and gone, and the time to comment on that trend with the Power Rangers, again, not only has that time come and gone, it's been done, and done well with that short film. So, I have a feeling that this is likely to fall flat because the filmmakers are behind what the fans want. And what I mean by behind is what they think the fans want is 5 years too late of what the fans want now, if that makes any sense.
Mm-hmm. Maybe what they're trying to do is attract new fans.
Really?
Like, well, here's my theory.
Because I feel like this is like, you thought you knew Power Rangers, but if you were a kid when it came out, this is a whole new game. This ain't your granddad's Power Rangers.
Yeah, there you go. See, your granddad's Power Rangers. This is
my
you,
granddad
this is...
didn't have Power Rangers, Bill.
He had Super
but
Sentai.
No, but here's the thing. This is this isn't your father's Power Rangers, essentially.
My dad didn't have Power Rangers either. My dad just had racism. And a low-paying job. That's all my dad had.
And a mustache?
He had a mustache. My dad's not racist, by the way. Not really.
You guys, that's when America was great.
We can get back there again. Anyway, all right. Anybody have anything else they wanted to say specifically about the trailer? Otherwise, I want to move on to the Megazord just to save time.
No.
Okay, so no. I'll ask one thing. Two things, actually. I'm sorry. One.
Fuck.
We get a brief glimpse of the command center on the inside. I think it looks... what do you got? Because I think it looks too much
it doesn't
like...
look. It doesn't look special. It doesn't look anything special.
It looks like the interior of the Romulan ship in the first J.J. Abrams Star Trek movie. Like that weird spiky green misty look. I'm not really feeling it. I do, however, like the suits, the glimpse that we get in motion. How do you guys feel about that? The little glimpse that we get.
A part of me got really excited seeing the glimpse of the suit.
Yeah, I kind of think it looks great in motion. We'll see.
And I did got excited like hearing the little bits of the bum 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 bum. A little part of me was like kind of squealed with joy.
Yeah, I'm not sold on the theme. I have a feeling whatever version of the theme they end up doing is going to be shit, but if that last Ghostbusters song they did was any indication. But
You're gonna have fucking like Fall Out Boy record the theme song.
Although Walk the Moon did a version of it that is pretty much just the Ray Parker Jr. version, and it's pretty good. So maybe they'll do that. Maybe Walk the Moon will just do a straight Go-Go Power Rangers, and that'll be pretty good.
Figure. They went back to the original, and it was better. Go figure.
Yeah, right? Well, they should just get Walk the Moon to do it. They'd probably be pretty good for it. They got that vibe. All right. So moving on then. The Megazord. Andres,
yes.
I'm going to let you off the leash here, and I may have to rein you in, but we'll see. All right, here we go. You ready?
Oh, by the way, I have the toys, if you want. There were, like, toys leaked of the Morpher and the Power Coins.
Oh, they leaked the Morpher, too?
Yeah, yeah.
Does it look like the classic one? Is it a belt buckle?
Bill, what if you let him
off? That. I can get
what if you let
like
him
that.
Off the leash?
For me,
what if you let
Andres
off the leash and he's just like, meh?
See, I think that I think that the
it looks like a bunch of melted plastic.
Yeah, but
with, like, it's like it's a melted piece of plastic with a bunch of 20-year-old pet. What do you call them? We call them tazos, I think, in Mexico. What are they called? Pogs. They look like a bunch of 20-year-old pogs.
Okay, you know what? I'm okay with the way the Morpher looks.
Yeah, I'm okay with it, too.
The power coins, on the other hand, kind of just looks like somebody, like, spilled some fruit juice on a wafer.
See, they look
like jelly cookies, actually. Yeah, yeah. You got your strawberry flavor, blueberry flavor, lemon flavor, blackberry, like and cherry.
Like, these look delicious. I want to go buy some now, is what I'm saying. You can't even see the tiger.
It looks like somebody took the toys from, like, the mid-90s, and they're, like, just, like, stripped them of all their color and all the logos and everything, and this is just, like, the skeleton? Like, that's what the Morpher looks like? That's what the power coins look like?
Actually, that's the toy. I just realized that a couple months back, these were what the Morphers are going to look like.
Oh, no, that's a different proposition altogether. That looks like some weird shit. See, are you sure that those are the Morphers, or are those where the power coins come from? Because in the trailer... In the trailer, they get the power coins out of that weird-looking black rock, and they're in... It looks like the coins are, like, inside of, like, a rock. Like, they're inside of a crystal. That's what that looks like to me. That doesn't look like a Morpher to me. It looks like just, like, what the power coins are found in.
It could be possible that these things could turn into the Morpher, the weird spiral Morpher.
Which would also be kind of Dino Thundery, because in that you had, like, a bracelet that turned into the Morpher. That was, like, a weird rocky crystal bracelet. By the way, I know this is going to bring us on a tangent that we should probably not do for time's sake, but I just want to say, in Dino Thunder, when Tommy is like, so you know how having a dinosaur's head on your wrist is kind of not discreet? Like, if somebody saw that, they'd be like, you're a Power Ranger. Sure. Fair enough. So they disguise them. They have them turn into, like, the bracelets with the crystal on them to make them look a little bit more kind of just like jewelry. But the problem is, the Dino Thunder logo is on the bracelet. And the logo is on the Power Rangers belt buckle. So it's almost worse than the actual Morpher, because at least the Morpher is just a dinosaur. Like, you could be like, oh, I'm just a big fan of dinosaurs. Like, I really like this, like, a watch. But instead, it's like, oh, no, you've got the logo for the team on there. Like, that, like, it's so, it, like, ugh, Tommy's an idiot. Anyway. So, Andres, I'm letting you off the leash. Go ahead. Talk about how much you hate the Megazord.
Okay, I fucking hate this thing. I feel like it's a very lazy design. I feel like with the Megazord, I feel like you could have taken it into one of two directions. Either you would have changed the original Daijujin design, you know, move the colors around or change the helmet design, change everything, but still keep that same kind of general Pacific Rim, blocky, large panel aesthetic. Or you can change the aesthetic, but still preserve, like, the design, the Daijujin design. You know, similar helmet, similar placement of the body, of the colors and body parts. This design does away with both the aesthetic and the design. You end up with something that looks like a dude in a black chainmail morph suit with a bunch of random bits of ugly armor attached to him, and with colors randomly splashed everywhere. Which makes me think that this design was not necessarily used for the movie, but maybe this was a design that came from something else entirely that they just dug out of the old file cabinet, slapped some colors on there, and called it a Megazord. It's boring, it's unimaginative, it doesn't invoke neither the spirit nor the charm of the original Megazords, and most importantly of all, it doesn't look like a combiner. And that's what I liked about the idea of the Megazord. With it being a combiner, it kind of represents the unity of a group of team, a group of five or more individuals coming together as one single unit. Here, that theme is lost entirely when you drop the combiner aesthetic altogether, because it doesn't, because of how boring and plain the humanoid black mesh suit part kind of dominates this entire design. It looks like these Zords are more than likely going to morph into this one singular body rather than creatively combining and folding into the proper Megazord that we all know and love. So yeah. I don't like it.
I agree with everything he said.
For many, many reasons. And the thing is,
maybe it's something you need to see in motion.
Maybe, but still, it's like, that's not going to change the overall design. It's still going to look like a dude in armor rather than being looking like a combination of different robot parts. I mean, the concept itself is so fucking amazing. It's five robot prehistoric animals that combine together into a giant warrior. How do you fuck that up?
Well, they tried to make it look like Gork from the Day of the Earth Stood Still remake.
It looks like a fucking battleizer. It looks like fucking...
Yeah.
It looks like they're gonna. It looks like they're gonna like Magna Defender this shit, and one of the Rangers is just gonna grow giant and get a bunch of armor attachments. Like that's
yeah.
What
well,
it
looks like they. It looks like they weirdly tried to like reference the fact that the old Megazord was a guy in a suit by making it kind of look like you said, Andres, a guy wearing a suit,
which is really
and it
weird.
Doesn't work.
And it's really weird because what kind of world do we live in when the Power Rangers are wearing more armor than the Megazord itself?
Yeah, well, yeah, that is weird, yeah.
Well, the other problem is, you guys get, like, a major, like, Bayformers vibe off of the Megazord.
In the chest,
really.
Yeah? And only in the chest area.
It feels like a fucking Bayformer to me, because everything, the head, the feet, the whole, like, you know, just sharp pieces of metal jutting out randomly with no discernible shape at all. Like, it just, the whole thing feels very Bayformers to me.
And like, I shared this image.
But it's all smooth, though. The Bayformers are all jagged.
Yeah. True, yeah. I did share this redesign with you guys, where there's someone who kind of tried to pull off a similar aesthetic by taking the original Megazord and kind of slim him down, give him more of like a muscular proportioned arms and legs and even like a six-pack. Yet this redesign feels more like the Megazord than the thing we have before us.
I think they fucked it up all with the head. I think the head is really... See, Andres, if you took the old Daijujin head and you just stuck it on that new design, I feel like that makes it like a million times better. Because you look at the rest of it and you go, yeah, whatever, but the face is the important thing that they nailed. This one just doesn't have a face. So
no, it doesn't.
There's nothing to fall back on. You know, you just look at the face and you're like, oh, there's nothing, and we lost Dylan. See, that was so bad it knocked Dylan out of the call. and then you just look down and it just gets worse from there. I think that's the real kicker here.
It's like, they just took everything that made the Megazord iconic, that made the Megazord recognizable, that made the Megazord the fucking Megazord. They threw it out and threw it in the trash, thinking that their own shit is better than what came before.
Yeah, I just... And again, I'm with David. We need to see it in motion before I can really go, this is garbage, they fucked up, fuck them. But...
Oh yeah, that does look like a Bayformer Megazord.
Hang on, let me see here. That's better than this, though.
True, that is true. That is better.
That is better than this still.
You know, I would say Optimus Prime looks more... Bayformer Optimus looks closer to Optimus than this looks closer to the Megazord.
The only problem with this Megazord is that the eyes are too spread apart, so he looks like... He looks kind of like cross-eyed.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he looks like... Ugh. Whereas this Megazord is just like, I've got nothing, because they didn't think to give me a face.
And the thing is, like, you know, I feel like Pacific Rim was a really... I really wish they would have hired, like, maybe, like, the mech designers from Pacific Rim, because they look more like Megazords than this thing does.
Now, on this... Go ahead, I'm sorry.
I'm sharing this image that was shared to me by Denny, where it looks... This is, like, a very Pacific Rim-styled Megazord and Dragon Sword. And it just, like, it tears me up inside, knowing that there have been so many badass fan... interpretations of the Megazord. And, you know, when I first heard that, you know, for me, I fucking love giant robots. You know, they're my big bread and butter after giant monsters. And with the Megazord, you know, it's like I know I'm probably gonna sound like a stupid blubbering fanboy just talking about how much
too late.
How much emotion emotionally invested
you're amongst
for a
fellow...
fucking robot.
Andres, I have a mullet. You're safe. It's fine. Yeah.
But the thing is,
nothing you do will ever be mock-worthy again in light of Bill's mullet. We all look good now, you know?
Mm-hmm.
We finally have the friend that makes the rest of us look amazing by way of their mullet.
I hate you.
Thank you guys. But yeah, the Megazord, the Megazord was like my gateway drug into like mech giant robot fiction. And so it's like, he's still standing. Daijujin still stands.
Injecting Megazords into your bloodstream? Ugh.
Yeah,
you were kicked out of so many Toys R Us's as a kid.
He was what introduced me made me realize how awesome giant robots are. And so when I first heard that there was going to be a big budget Power Rangers reboot adaptation film, my mind was like soared with ideas as to how they could reinterpret the Megazord. I started seeing like all this kind of fan art. I'm thinking to myself, wow, there's so much potential for the Megazord to be brought back and people to view him as more than just a simple man in a cheap blocky suit. And then I see this shit, and then I look back at the fan art, and it makes me realize how much lost potential there was. And I know it's just a giant robot. And it's like, oh, just wait for the rest of the movie to come. Maybe the rest of the movie will be come out. However, if this movie's going to follow the Power Rangers structure, the structure of a general Power Ranger like plot structure, this robot is going to represent their climax. This is like the money shot.
Yeah.
This is what they have saved for the very finale of the movie. This is supposed to be like the thing that everyone's going to work hard for. So to have your climax build up to this piece of shit, then what's there to look forward to?
I can see that. Another way you could look at that is, I don't think this will be in the movie very much. It'll probably just be in the finale. And yeah, you are right. I didn't think about it that way. That is a good way to... Well, not a good way to look at it, but that is probably a more realistic way to look at it. But at the same time, I don't think that because this is bad, it's an indication that the rest of the movie is bad. I think that it's an indication of, they've made some really poor design choices, and that might impact the rest of the movie slightly, but it's not a death sentence yet.
But so it we'll is see. Possible that this could be a reflection of the mindset put
definitely,
into this movie.
Everything I've seen from this thing so far has gone, this could mean that this is a dead project, it's already done, it's already decided that it's going to be shit, but we don't know yet. I haven't seen anything yet that's definitely cemented that in my mind, but it's a possibility.
Actually,
compare it to Bayformers, like I did before. You know, I enjoy the first Bayformer movie, and again, you know, design choices were made that I don't necessarily agree with, but it ultimately didn't ruin the movie for me. And I think is even more of a problem for that franchise than it is for this, because they're like, most of the movie is about those characters, you know. So I mean, so I think there is a possibility that we might still enjoy the movie despite the fact that we don't like the way the Megazord looks. I think the rest of it could still save it. I just think that it's not a very good indication. It doesn't help my expectations at all.
Yeah, and Andreas, I think you hit the nail on the head. It's boring. It's bland. It doesn't evoke any kind of wonder. It just looks like Gort from the Day the Earth Stood Still movie, the remake.
I don't think so.
The remake is what I'm saying? Like the smooth, like...
I think it looks like...
What?
Yeah, maybe Gort if he had Battleizer armor, I guess.
Yeah,
or
but,
Gort
yeah, but,
that.
Yeah, but take
Gort
the...
Gort got when he came back from Mardi Gras.
Yeah, take the armor off him, and it's like the smooth, like kind of nanite metal thing is where I got the Gort vibe. Just in terms of...
Oh, okay.
I think there's a push...
I don't like to think about the remake.
There's a push against like boxy robots in movies a lot, where it's like, let's do something more kind of sleek and kind of liquid metal-y. And this is
And a lot of detail.
This is clearly like heading in that direction. And I'm with you guys. It doesn't work for me. Does anybody else have anything they wanted to say about the new Power Rangers movie? All the shit we've seen. Anything else?
I think the one good thing I can say about the Megazord is that it doesn't have a mullet.
Yeah.
Oh, no, he's got those spikes in the back, those pink spikes in the back. Man, it's supposed to invoke some invoke.
That's more of like a crop top, though, you know, where it's just like...
Maybe in the next movie, when it combines with the Dragon Zord, it'll get a nice mullet going on, you
I
know?
I hope so. That's my dream. David, what were you going to say?
I was gonna say that what if this Megazord is not supposed to be a remake of the Daijujin Megazord? This is supposed to be like a completely independent design from that.
It's made up of the same Zords, though.
Yeah. We know for a fact that there's going to be a T-Rex, a Mastodon, and so on.
Yeah, but
I mean,
they,
not all of
swords are in the same positions, though. Like, it looks like the pink one is the head now or something, because there's pink on the head.
Yeah, she was always just the chest piece originally.
What if this variation is not supposed to be, like, a remake of the Daijujin Megazord? Mm. Kind of like,
Yeah, obviously, yeah, but still, there's nothing here that invokes the original design.
It's not so much a problem that it doesn't look like Daijujin, it's a problem that it doesn't look like a Megazord. The only thing that reminds me of any Megazord is there's one picture of one of the toys where he has like a drill on his hand that looks like the T-Rex's tail, and that's straight out of Dino Thunder. That's the only thing I can think of that, like, I say, oh, it's a Megazord. And I'll say that out of the pictures we have of it, that image that I'm talking about is certainly the best.
Yeah, because it's got the most shit on it. Yeah, but I think that the comparison to the movie Megazord, like the first movie Megazord, is probably the best, especially in terms of the head. Mm-hmm. And again, I think that's why it sucks, kind of.
Do you think there's a possibility? Because there's got to be a reason why all these different images of the Megazord we've seen and all the different toys look different. I think it's possible that, like, the one that we actually do kind of like, the one that's the most blocky, might be the final one that they wind up fighting with, and maybe the other one just exists in, like, a flashback or something.
No, I think that it's going to get different pieces put on it as the fight progresses. I think it's going to get... Yeah, that's what I'm talking about, Andres, the Ninja Megazord. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
That is exactly what it looks like. Well, not exactly, but it's got a lot of similar elements, especially the smooth kind of texture. But I think that we're going to get, like, it's going to start out just kind of bare bones, like the Zords come together and it's got that, like, kind of basic kind of figure. And then it's going to get different bits of the Zords put on. I think maybe... Not
like, some people think that maybe Zordon is the Megazord, and maybe the other... Maybe Zordon is, like, the black morph suit motherfucker, and he gets, like, he wears the other Zords on him, like, armor.
If that's
true... So he would kind of become what Daijujin was in the original G-Ranger, sort of an intelligence behind Megazord.
Yeah, I mean, at that point, it's also a problem with that show where it's like, why do they even have to pilot it? But like, I would ask that 10 times more in this. Like, why are they even in there then? Why is he risking these children's lives if he's just going to do it himself?
Least it would give him something to do, though. I mean, Zordon always just sort of... The only useful thing Zordon ever did was commit suicide, okay?
Maybe it's an Ultraman dilemma where Zordon needs a host.
Okay, but that's inside of his body. But why can't he, like, hijack a dude's body, then?
Maybe he needs 5 children.
Oh, my God.
Whoa.
This is a much better sounding movie. Why didn't they just make an American Ultraman movie?
Way more interesting than what I thought it would be. All right. Anybody else have anything else they want to throw out there? It's mad late. I'm tired. Better be something good. No?
No. I've exhausted my rage.
All right.
My fanboy rage.
I just want to thank Dylan for making me even more depressed knowing that there's never going to be a Hollywood Ultraman movie.
Especially not if it doesn't have Will Smith in it.
Oh, yeah, that's not going to happen. And we also know that, like, what's that motherfucker's name? The guy who ended up stealing the international distribution rights for Ultraman?
Oh, shit. How do you not know this? Chayo.
Chayo, yeah. But no, the guy...
How do I know that Chayo. You don't?
Sapote something? I don't know.
Sapote. This guy, you know, there's no way he's going to be able to pull something off like that. The dude's an idiot.
Well, he's not.
He said, like, a year ago, he said he was going to make Blu-ray releases of, like, the 6 Ultraman shows in Jumborghese. It's been a year, and we've seen jack shit.
Well, I don't think he is, and I don't think he's going to produce that Hollywood movie, because he's the main reason why neither of them can produce a Hollywood Ultraman movie.
Right. Like he's burned the bridge and then some with Tsuburaya Productions.
Do you guys think that
as much as he would like to say otherwise, he really doesn't have the rights to do so.
Yeah.
If Tsuburaya had all the rights to Ultraman, international, everywhere, domestic, just the complete rights, do you think they would have made a Hollywood movie by now?
But they would have done it in the 90s.
Really?
Well, actually, they did. They did.
Yeah,
actually.
They did. They made an American Ultraman show called Ultraman the Ultimate Hero, but it was never released in America, ironically.
Oh, was that the Australian one?
No. That was after the Australian one.
which ironically starred the Black Ranger from Kaku Ranger.
Oh, hey, huh.
And the same guy from Final Wars.
Oh, all right, this is blowing my mind now. Why don't we wrap this up, then? There's so much tokusatsu fun facts being spewed at me. I'm not having fun anymore. No.
I'm going deeper, Leo.
Yeah. All right. So, until next time, everyone, that's going to do it for this week's episode of the Sons of Sarazawa podcast. My news certainly feels rounded up. So, until next time, everyone, as always, you can find us at the Sons of Sarazawa Network homepage on Facebook. You can like the Godzilla Odyssey page on Facebook. We should be putting up another one in a couple days, so look out for that. Or that one will probably be up already by the time this goes up, so just look for that on my channel. You can like that page, though, to get all those a day early on the day we actually record them, so you can go like that page for that. You can also follow me on Twitter at @Bill_Worster. You can follow me on Facebook. You can just find me. I'm there. Just search for me, will you? Make me feel important.
The first thing they'll find is that Dank Bill memes page.
Oh, I forgot about the Dank Bill memes page. You can also
which in less than 24 hours will be full of images of your freshly mulleted head.
Oh, I hate you people. Why am I friends with you guys? What did I do to deserve this? I don't answer.
You got a mullet.
Because we're the only ones who care.
That's true. Ugh. I'm gonna go die now. All right. Until next time, everyone. I'm Bill Worster, aka Zazzy Bark.
Bill, you have a Godzilla Odyssey page?
Oh.
How did I not know this?
Oh.
Yeah. We've had one.
David, just say goodnight, please.
Two fucking years.
David, you didn't say your name. How do
you? I did.
Did you?
No, you didn't.
I did.
Say it again.
See what happens when you have a mullet, Bill?
My mullet is not blocking my ears. I can hear you. Say your name.
I don't know if you guys noticed it, but Bill freakishly looks like Andrew right now.
Dylan,
or for
just,
the whole
stole
Dylan,
it, man. He stole
Dylan,
it. Stole Dylan, it, man.
Dylan, skip him. He doesn't deserve it.
I'm skipping Dave. Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
All right. I'm Super DM64, I guess. And between Dave's shenanigans and Bill's mullet, I'm the one who should be questioning my choice in friends.
I'm Andres Perez, a.k.a. Kaiji Noir, and I'm fucking losing my mind.
Aren't we all, man?
Or for what, you may ask? Everything.
Aren't we all?
Including Bill's mullet.
All right, kids. The science is definitely not sound. We're scared for our lives over here. Please send help.